December 7th at 7 p.m. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Fire evacuation, right out through the doors right behind you. Please, right out to the center of the town green, or out through these doors on your right-hand side, down the stairs, and as far away from the building as possible. Thank you. Will the secretary please call the roll?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Lou Fiore.
Here.
Virginia Higley.
Here.
Linda DeGray.
Here.
John Petronella is here. Francis Alamo.
Here.
Here.
Kenneth Helensky.
Here.
Vinny Grillo. He's absent.
Christy
D'Antonio.
Here.
And Nicholas Lefakis.
Here.
Let the record show that we have a full membership tonight, all seven regular members and all three alternates. So the alternates, I assume two of the alternates, sorry, nine members. So the alternates will not be seated tonight unless there's a recusal during one of the regular hearings. Approval minutes. I'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes of November 16th.
So moved.
Motion made by Vice Chairman Higley, seconded by Vice Chairman DeGray. Any discussion? Yep. Oh, and before we start, may I please add, we don't have a physical minutes taker here tonight, so Lori's kind of filling in, so let's take our time slowly when we make comments tonight. Yeah, please. Welcome.
Okay, on page 4, first paragraph, 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth line, it should be 14 and not 4. It says restricted and 4. Should be 14. And then there was one other.
Everybody have that? Everybody see that?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, wait a second, there was one other place. On page 8, third paragraph, second line, it said some medical issues and other matters. I think we should say waiting for a decision from the Army Corps of Engineers.
Well, it was both.
Because it was both a medical and the Army Corps of Engineers.
So that was stated?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it was stated, yes.
And that's it.
Thank you. I just had one on page 1, only because it's I think it's a typo. If you go down to the enforcement officer's report, and it says the O-ring has been installed. I'm not sure. I know everything's been installed, but I'm not sure what was supposed to be there.
Boring,
B-O-R-I-N-G? Could be. All right. Well, I'll take that.
I don't know what it was referencing offhand.
So. Sure. I'll take that. But I know thoring isn't a word, so I'll take boring. Does everybody have that change there? Everybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
So I'll entertain a motion to accept the minutes as amended.
So moved.
Motion made by Vice Chairman Higley, seconded by Vice Chairman DeGray to accept the minutes as amended. Any discussion? Seeing that, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Let the record show is unanimous to accept the minutes. Any abstentions from the minutes, since we did have a couple members that weren't there?
No, Mr. Chair. I had watched the entire meeting on the...
Okay. Me as well. I watched.
Okay, so there's no abstentions.
I did as well.
Okay. Everybody... Moving on. Everybody didn't get a copy of the town attorney's report on November 27th?
Yep.
Okay. There's no executive session. There's no enforcement officer's report unless there's something from the staff. No? We move on to public communications. At this point in the meeting, the Planning and Zoning Commission welcomes comments, concerns, and opinions related to planning and zoning in Enfield from anyone who is present, provided that no one may discuss any matter of business at this time that is already elsewhere on the agenda, any matter that is part of an open public hearing of this commission, front of this commission, or any matter where a decision of this commission may still be pending, that includes anything that's in legal limbo. So is there anyone who'd like to come in front of us at this point? Sure, certainly.
John? Hello?
Yep.
Jeffrey Foss, 16 Crescent Beach Drive, Enfield. I brought a petition tonight. I just want to read it off, and I'm going to hand it in.
Does that matter towards any particular application that's on our agenda tonight, Mr. Voss?
Yes.
Then that needs to wait to the open public hearing, please.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Okay.
Anyone else like to come in front of us? For a third time? Seeing none, public participation is closed. No bond releases tonight? So now we're going back to reopen the public hearing of PH 3078. I don't believe we need to reread that again, but that is the application of impact residential development for mixed-use development on a variety of different addresses. Would the applicant or representative like to come forward, please? And again, this is a public hearing that we kept open from the last meeting. Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. How are you tonight? Good evening. For the record, my name is Chris Smith. I'm a land use attorney with the law firm of Alter & Pearson, and I appear before you this evening on behalf of the applicant, Impact Residential Development LLC, concerning the special permit application for a multifamily residential community with an office component be located here in Enfield. And in compliance with your zoning regulations in the Thompsonville District 5 area. I'd like to, at the outset, introduce the members of the team who are here this evening. From Collaborative Development LLC, Peter Wood, and these were individuals that were here at the prior hearing on November 16th. From Paul Bailey Architect LLC, we have our architect, Susan Odell, who's on my left. From the BSC group, we have Frank Vaca, the senior project manager, as well as Sam Ofi Ado, who is a transportation engineer with BSC. We're just gathering enough chairs so that we're all up here, Mr. Chairman. And this evening, we do have a representative from Impact Residential Development, Jessica Mullins, who is sitting on my immediate right. And with your permission, I think Jessica does have some initial comments that she may like to make and address the commission this evening.
Before we start, sometimes those portable mics do work. If you want to give that a shot, that might be easier. I think if you turn on, you have to wait.
Sometimes it's delayed.
Yeah.
Testing.
There you go.
All right. Very good.
Magic.
With your permission, Chair. Fantastic. Good evening, everyone. My name is Jessica Mullins. I'm the president of Impact Residential Development. We are a national development firm. We specialize in ground-up development, residential in focus. We believe that this focus will help solve our national housing crisis. Our company is funded through the chairman of Starwood Capital Group. It's a global real estate investment firm. We own over 100,000 units across the country and bring a great deal of expertise to all the communities that we collaborate with different jurisdictions on. We believe in long-term value. It drives our commitment to quality finishes. We have comprehensive services for all of our residents and the community at large. We also are long-term owners, and we are strive in every neighborhood to be the best neighbors and make a contribution of value in every community. My personal background is I am an impact investor by trade. I also do a lot of public-private partnerships around the country for decades. And so very excited to be here and to be able to collaborate with the township. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jessica. As the Commission's aware, we did have our first night of public hearing at your last meeting on November 16th, and we did receive comments and suggestions from not only the Commission, but also members of the public. We did, during the interlude between then and now, and we did look at the various comments and suggestions, and we did submit supplemental material. And with the permission of the Chair, what we'd like to do is go through those, the supplemental material this evening. We've broken it down into really three categories, and the first two involve parking and traffic, trip generation. The third involves stormwater management and quality, and the third involves or concerns some landscape revisions that were made as well as revisions to the architectural design. And with the permission of the Chair, I'd like to turn our presentation over to our traffic engineer from the BSC group, Mr. Alfie Ado, who is a transportation engineer, and Mr. Rideau will walk you through, again, a little bit more information concerning the parking in the neighborhood, as well as he'll review again some of the findings and conclusions in the traffic report that was submitted to the commission with the initial application. So thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. For the record, my name is Francis Vaca from the BSC Group. I'm going to turn this over to Mr. Alfiadeau in a moment. I just wanted to just reiterate that in order to be in accordance with the parking regulations for the zone, it is we need a requirement for 111 parking spaces. We are providing 70 for the residents plus 6 additional on-site for the office space that is provided, which means that there are 141 spaces left to satisfy the parking requirement. I would like to turn the presentation over to Samuel today just to kind of explain a little bit more information on parking calculations for this.
And before Mr. O'Day starts, what I would like to do for the record, Chris Smith, I'd just like to point out that Mr. Vaca just indicated with the prior slide, there is going to be off-site parking, and that is being provided pursuant to your regulations that you recently adopted for this particular area. And I know that you had a planning consultant that you worked with, as well as your professional staff, who is very good, all three of them that are here this evening, all three of the individuals in their capacities and expertise. And I think that you had input on off-site parking in this type of a transit-oriented development type of use because of the flex parking and having alternative off-site parking available, that you do provide a credit for up to 50%. So we have applied that regulation, and we do meet that. I would also like to note that what you're going to hear is, as you're well aware, most traffic studies are done relative to trip generation, using information from the ITE, or the International Transportation Engineer Manual. Well, they also, as part of their data that they've accumulated over the years across the country, they also have parking. Not only do they have peak flows for certain types of uses, but they have parking demands for certain types of uses. And we'll be referring to that in this portion of the presentation, but I just wanted to emphasize, I know that this commission is familiar with it, all the commissions are throughout the state. Personally, I'm just finding more and more that we're turning to parking, the ITE study, for data to back up, to address the parking issues when there's an application, because you don't have any track record in town for this type of use. So the ITE does provide that information. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris. So yeah, my name is Simon Fayado, a professional engineer with BSC Group. And as attorney said, see, ITE is a national, actually an international body, and where planners and transportation engineers really do belong. And they have this database that is collected across the country. And as you can see on the slide, this is data for multifamily residential units. And the data was actually collected between 10 p.m. and 5 p.m. That is really the maximum demand. That's when everybody is home, usually, so the data is between that time. And that's the maximum demand of parking. And it's also collected for multifamily units that are within half a mile of a real transit station. And as you could see, the average rate, and this is based on the number of bedrooms in the apartment, the average rate is 0.61 spaces per one-bedroom unit. And for the number of units being proposed under this development, the 70 units, and then it comes to 111 bedrooms, and the number of spaces, according to ITE, would be 68 spaces. We looked at it in two different ways. We have the average rate, and there's also, you know, as they collect the data, they have several data points, and they're able to, you know, draw a graph through it. So there is an equation too that comes through it, and it's a very, very good equation, because the correlation is very high. So if we use the equation, it's about 72 spaces. So we've been using those two methodologies. You can see that the number of spaces, in accordance to the ITE parking generation manual, It's about 72 spaces for such a development. And that is what I wanted to talk about. I know Frank has a few things to say on the parking. Then I'll talk to the Trip Generation.
Thank you, Sam. And again, and just to clarify with regard to the IT, that is previous information that was actually calculated and observed at other developments throughout the country. Now, as far as the other items that I wanted to discuss briefly was there are 70 spaces provided on site. There are also 70 units on site. Therefore, there is the potential for that there to be one space per unit available. That's not a guarantee, but it's just to reiterate the fact that there is the potential to have one unit per space throughout the development. And again, as I reiterated in the past, there's 111 spaces provided minus the 70 provided for the residential indicate that there are 40 spaces offsite per the regulations. What I'd like to identify with this slide is that the majority of the people, when they're going to park in those offsite spaces, they want to park as close to the development, close to the destination that they're hoping to park at as possible. So the numbers that you're identifying here are showing the number of off-street parallel spaces that are directly adjacent to development. There are nine spaces along Church Street here, 12 spaces along Pleasant, and I would like to note that I did not include any of the spaces that were in front of any of the residences in here. I'm including 14 spaces along North Main Street. There are in total 15, but I'm not including the one associated with the Cinco de Mayo truck, which equals a total of 35 directly adjacent to the parcel. And then there is also the 23 spaces they were allowed to use per the 50% of the municipal lot, equaling a total of 58 spaces total that are directly adjacent to the site. Again, in order to meet the requirement, we would only need 41 of those spaces. I'm going to turn this back over to Sam with regard. There was a question in the previous meeting with regard to Trip Generation and the traffic associated with the development.
Thank you, Frank. Mr. Chairman, just drawing attention to the number of trips. So the proposed development had the residential units as well as the office space. So looking at the total number of trips over the course of the day, so we look at the 24-hour trips, and we also look at it during the morning as well as the afternoon peak hour. And the peak periods are really when you have a lot of traffic on the roadway. So during the morning, based on the IT Trip Generation, that's the 11th edition, the current edition, there would be 10 vehicle or 10 trips entering and 21 trips exiting for a total of 31. And that's a 1 hour period between 7 and 9 in the morning. And also for 1 hour period between 4 and 6 in the afternoon, we are expecting a total of 33 vehicles. That'll be 19 entering and 14 exiting. And I use the word trips because it could be one vehicle that could, you know, leave, go drop somebody off, come back. That'll be two trips. But it's essentially just one vehicle going up and down. So we really look at it in terms of trips, not in terms of cars, because it might not be unique vehicles. And with respect to the analysis which we did and we presented in the report, there is no change in what we call the level of service or the quality of travel in the study areas. If you look at the number of vehicles, essentially in the morning we are saying that trips that could be attributed to this development is like one vehicle every 2 minutes. And compared to what is already existing in the area, it doesn't really change the trip characteristics for the neighborhood. And that is the conclusion we reached with our report.
With regard to brought to my understanding that there was some concern with regard to some of the drainage proposed on the site.
I like to do excellent. You'll hear shuffling my papers. Before we leave drainage,
absolutely.
Maybe we could ask some questions as each section as you're going through. Does that make sense to you?
Whatever works for your.
Does that make sense to everyone here?
So, Mr. Chairman.
So we just heard about the traffic and some of the parking issues. Do you have any questions, Commissioner DeGray?
couple of questions about the parking. Currently, what will be part of your property on Pleasant Street is a parking lot that used to be, had a sign that said public, so people could park in there. There's like 27 spots in there. They're going to be removed where people were able to park during the winter storms. I mean, there's no parking on the streets. And then you're saying all of these lots are the street parking and that will not be available during storms. And all of the parking lots currently, when there is a storm, are full. So where do the 41 spaces come from when currently all those spots are full? And then the traffic, you're talking about 362 trips, both morning and night. Have you included your analysis with once the train station opens in a few years? Because now we're going to have a bigger increase in traffic. So I'm just wondering if that's part of your analysis.
Thank you. With respect to the number of trips, what we did with the trip generation, see, there are two ways to look at it. We look at it actually in a conservative way, where we looked at it as if there wasn't any train station there. You know, so, but if there were train stations, then you have fewer people driving because there were some that would walk to the train station. So the number of trips would be less. But analysis assumed that it was just the regular apartment, so that the numbers were actually higher. So it does really take into account. In terms of the number of trips, it's really, we look at the worst case scenario for the number of trips.
Okay.
And then you can talk about
that. Just one more thing, because I've had the opportunity to be involved with properties that are in urban settings with transit available. One in Manchester with a bus stop right out the front door, people really didn't use it, and one in Stamford where we had a bus stop in the front and actual train platform in the back door, and we had a parking garage, and we still had problems with not having enough parking. So I'm seeing some concerns about the parking during the winter, and I know that you guys aren't the property managers, you're just the builders and owners, but people who live there are going to have an issue. So that's just a concern you can address. All right, thank you.
With the snow, I assume we work with the town and alternate either side. Usually that's how they do it.
With regard, go back to that. I'm sorry, let me find the right one here. As with regard to the 41 spaces, and again, and I know that the calculation is required in order to achieve whatever that 111 spaces are. The 111 spaces are the maximum required per the zoning regulation for this parking. And again, I understand the emotions associated with this. It is the reason why we provided the ITE parking is to say that, you know, given the previous experience of the number of TOD developments that have been designed, and I definitely appreciate your concerns with regard to your prior experience, it is the information that we have been provided as far as the parking, the IT parking is concerned, that those 41 spaces, it is our anticipation that they will not all be utilized. That is assuming that all of the 42 two-bedroom units will have two vehicles apiece. It is not our expectation that that will be the case. Therefore, the 41 spaces are the additional swing space that would be needed if the entire development had every single bedroom utilized with an individual car per each. It is not our expectation, and especially with a given the various transit modes, both the train station, the transit out, the bus station, I should say the bus stop that's located directly in front of Building A. There is a transit bus that actually connects to Hartford, and the pedestrian and bicycle access, all of the different transportation modes for the development. We are not anticipating that all 41 of those spaces will be utilized, if any of them at all. And as a result of that, which is why I focused on with this slide, the fact that those additional spaces that may be used will be placed directly adjacent to the development, and then during those snowstorms, snow issues, and so on, we will definitely work with the town as far as type of coordination, as far as alternating, clearing, or something like that. We're definitely willing to work with the town to ensure that, and especially management of the development, to ensure that we are not creating any burden associated with this development.
And if I may, Commissioner DeGray, Chris Smith for the record, Mr. Vaca did generate this because the purpose of this slide was, again, to demonstrate the parking that's immediately adjacent to the property and is located to the, actually to the side or to the south. So it's, we're not taking credit for spaces in front of the single family, the residential homes in the neighborhood. And the delta would be basically six spaces. There's 35 that are immediately adjacent, and the difference would be six, which would certainly be easily to be accommodated with the municipal lot, even with the train station once it opens. And it sounds like you might be in management to a degree, but if you can't provide parking for your tenants, then you're not going to have those tenants. At least that's my own personal experience. And
I got to tell you, I could not tell you the number of people we've explained. You only get one space, and they come and they have two cars, and it's winter, and they get towed or they get ticketed, and then they blame the management company. And you say, no, it's right here in your lease. You signed it. I've explained it to you. I've sent out notices to you. Doesn't matter. People get upset when their cars get towed and get ticketed. And our streets are so narrow down here. That's a big concern.
Understood. And obviously, Stamford is fairly unique, especially down by the train station, with all the development located to the south of it in that area. I just would like to point out, and one of the reasons I brought up your regulation is that you'd spent a lot of time with a consultant, and you spent a lot of time with, again, your professional staff and yourself coming up with regulations and a formula for parking to promote this type of development in this district. And we just respectfully submit that we more than meet it, even utilizing it. Just hope that you, I just wanted to remind you of that, because not only are you hearing from us that it will work, but I think you've heard from your own consultant, and you drafted a regulation that provides for this credit for the off-site parking. And in this particular instance, again, most of what we're taking credit for, we have most of those spaces are available immediately adjacent to the subject property. And I understand what you're saying, Commissioner DeGray, but I just wanted to point that out again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Helinski?
I have similar concerns as to Commissioner DeGray, especially during snowstorms. So I know we talked about this at the last meeting, and I'm asking, is there a possibility of putting a parking garage on the property within your complex? I know we talked about an underground garage, I believe, that you had rejected because of various issues. Okay, but is there a possibility to put a parking garage in that property to allow for additional parking without having to use the on-street parking?
Peter, I think you might want to respond to that. You might be best.
Yeah, I'm happy to respond to that.
Peter Wood, I'm the development consultant to Impact Residential. Part of my background is I have a master's in city and regional planning from the Pratt Institute. And typically what we see towns and cities do in regards to areas where there is a parking demand that can't be met by on-street parking or private parking is the construction of structured parking. Typically, you see that adjacent to train stations. In fact, a problem throughout Fairfield County and New Haven is you don't have sufficient parking next to the commuter rail. And so that's always been a demand that is needed when you have a rail platform that is actively used by the town. I know that's something that's been a discussion point here in Enfield. You know, you're not anticipating the train station to come online for two more years. That would be roughly at the equivalent time that this development would also be under construction. So the two would actually pair up nicely. I think it would be a wise investment for Enfield to consider creating structured parking. The size of this site at even acquiring an adjacent property is 1.75 acres, 1.78 to be specific, and there is not sufficient room to both provide the housing that's necessary for this to be a viable development and to create structured parking. It's frankly, as you can hear from the traffic engineer, we don't anticipate that we will come close to using the amount of parking that the regulation provides for. We have six spaces for the offices that will be in use in Building A. In addition to that, we have another 70 spaces, and the projections are that based on the national experience, only 68 to 72 spaces would likely be required by the residents in a development like this. So there's not sufficient demand to do so, and frankly, it's problematic for the financing that is used to develop these kinds of communities. It's a mix of public and private financing. We access, you know, funds from the Department of Housing, from Connecticut Housing Finance Authority. They allocate the federal tax credits, which allows for private investment into the development. And, you know, the cost of structured parking is, as you probably know, quite expensive. And it's an additional lift. These are all already very tight developments to do economically. And once you add underground or structured parking, it basically puts them out of the range of feasibility. So you almost never find that here in Connecticut. I know there are developments on the West Coast where, you know, in major cities where that has been something that's been funded, but it's not something that is part of the experience here in Connecticut where those public dollars are made available for those uses.
Okay, thank
and,
you.
Commissioner Holinsky, Chris Smith, for the record, I just want to supplement Mr. Wood's comment with just a reminder that this is providing 56 of these units out of the 70 will be offered to individuals and families that would qualify certainly under 830G for affordable housing. In fact, it's even a lesser amount. So that this is not a market rate development by any means, which does drive the financials to a significant degree, and not only with the funding issues, but just to, you know, from a reality standpoint, that's what we're talking about, and there is a demand for that, obviously, and we've heard from some of the members of the public at the last meeting, as well as I think that you know that there is that demand in this area of the town. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Frank first. He was first, if you don't mind. Commissioner Lima.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Okay. I forget your name. Sorry. The CEO of the...
Oh, Jessica Mullins.
Right. Thank you. Sorry. I was impressed with your resume, and I believe you were saying that you had a various number of housing units, and you're involved in a lot of the housing piece of it, right, and throughout the country. But you didn't mention mixed-use development. Do you do mixed-use development, or is it just primarily housing?
It is primarily housing. In the past, and other firms that I have been involved with, I have done a number of mixed-use communities, a number in Texas, for instance, mm-hmm. large master plan communities.
Okay. On the parking structure, if some land would become available that was in the vicinity, maybe owned by the town or privately, would you consider partnering with someone else or a municipality to build a parking structure? Or is that completely out of the picture?
Well, if the cost was funded by the town?
Not just the town, public, private. land that should become available, if there was a possibility, would you consider a parking structure that would serve the whole area, including, you know, if there's a problem with the train station and future development? I mean, we have to look beyond.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry?
It's something we could consider as a separate transaction outside of this particular development.
Mm-hmm.
But if the township had available land and had an interest in being a financial partner in the development of that parking structure,
mm-hmm.
it's certainly something that the group could consider.
Well, I'm glad you said that. So maybe that's a possibility, because I know where there's land, but I'm not speaking for anybody, but I'm saying that should be looked at. Along with Commissioner DeGray, I have experience in this area, a little different than hers. I had the honor and privilege to get hired by the Thompsonville Fire Department in 1979. I spent 36 years there, and I left there as chief 8 years ago. I retired. I spent every day of my childhood walking around down here and stayed there throughout my life as a firefighter. And I am very, very familiar with that area. So as far as the parking and the trips calculations, I really don't think that's a real big deal about trips right now, but I think parking is a big deal. You know, I was a young man driving big trucks around those streets in the wintertime and snow time and parking everywhere. And I think parking is an issue. And to be safe and to look forward too. I mean, you can't just look at this project, just this project. Other experience I had, I've had the opportunity to be on the Thompsonville Revitalization Committee, the Enfield Revitalization Committee, other boards and commissions. I spent a lot of time and a lot of effort to redevelop Thompsonville. And I'm sure you've seen the photos, how Thompsonville used to look. And that's the vision of the community, I believe, and from what I'm hearing. And I think what you proposed the first time was more in line with that kind of look of the mixed use. I was sitting here on the first go around, and this changed since then. Architecturally wise, you know, I don't want to blow my own horn, but look at the firehouse. I had a lot to do with that going up. Look how it was the outside of it, the architectural. That's how Thompsonville used to look. That's why the fire station kind of looks like that. So there's that to consider. So those are the few things I just wanted to get out there. The parking, the architectural, to bring it back to what it was. People want to see it like it used to be. You know, and right across from your development, your proposed development, there was a parking lot there. Those probably held 300 cars. And then good old urban renewal came and we lost that. But so I appreciate you guys have an interest in here and want to do something, but those are my feelings and my feelings from listening to the last meeting, seeing people testify in front of the council, the town council Monday night. I watched that as well. And I think if you can just go back and look at those old pictures and see that mixed-use development with the storefronts and the apartments upstairs and the parking structure. I mean, if you're willing, reach out to the town. Reach out to the council. Maybe there's land. There is land. I'm not going to say where it is, but I know there's land. You can build a 7 or 8-story parking garage down there. Now we're talking about starting to rebuild Thompsonville. I am very passionate. I was born and brought up here. I'm a first-generation Italian-American. My parents came here legally from Sicily. I went through the whole thing. They had a variety store in the neighborhood. So I know it all. I'm not a know-it-all, but I know it about Thompsonville.
Excuse me, Frank. Please, the audience needs to be quiet, please.
So I'm please. Not criticizing. I'm trying to help to give you some pointers, some ways to go here. And there's a lot of passionate people that are still around town that grew up here. So many people, all the families, they're still around. They were living in other parts of town. I mean, this starts to come. You may see more people coming to talk about it. We've been waiting 40 years. The fire station was the first thing that was built in 40 years. We had more consultants, people coming down and telling us all these stories. We're going to do this and we're going to do that. Books this thick about Thompsonville's going to look. They're all upstairs collecting dust. 40 years later, here we are. So it's got to be Thompsonville, and there's a lot. Go to the museum, the historical museum in Enfield. There's pictures available. They're everywhere. That's what we want to see. I think that's what people want to see.
Are you all set, Frank?
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
No problem. Vice Chairman Higley?
I didn't see any mention for guest parking. Where are you going to put the guests?
Yeah, I think the numbers that we looked at for the IT, at least it encompasses everything. So those were actual units, you know, with guest parking and everything included, that when they went to count them. So that's really how they collect the data. They don't go into this is residence, this is guest parking. They count everything. And those units do have guests at certain times. And so they were all included in the IT numbers, you know, as presented.
Also,
I'm just talking about the numbers. I mean, the facts of the numbers.
Also, you speak about off-street parking. The three streets you mentioned, not so much North Main, but the other two, have multifamily housing on them. And their residents park on the street. So you're gonna initiate a parking war. Forgetting about snow removal altogether, you're still gonna initiate a parking war. Enfield does not have a reliable bus system. People drive or they ride their bikes. You can't ride your bike to go to the grocery store. People need to go to the doctors. They need to go to their school functions at night, their children's school functions at night. You're not taking into consideration that most people, most marriages have at least two cars. I have three because I can't get anywhere without a car. There is no bus service in my neighborhood. So I think that you need to really look hard at your parking because I don't think it's reality at all.
All set.
Thank
you.
Okay.
Commissioner D'Antonio?
Yeah, I'd just like to come at this from a slightly different approach from the others. I mean, we can see here they do meet the regulations. Appreciate you sharing how, again, you do meet the regulations, and you're not kind of pushing up against the edge of it either. You can technically do up to 50% offsite. You are not even pushing up against the 50% offsite. So they're not stretching the limits of our regulations either. And they've shown from past experience, past data, that this is realistic. So that is entirely valid. I think a lot of the points being brought up with parking in Thompsonville, that includes street parking as well as municipal parking, potential, you know, structured parking as well, public, possibly public, private. It's not the responsibility of this applicant. The town does have responsibility to manage its streets and manage its municipal parking lots. It's not realistic to put this burden on the applicant. There are strategies that we can take as a town, part of our planning role, working with town council as well, to develop parking strategies, especially for a place like Thompsonville, where it's growing in demand and growing in residences and growing in parking need. So these are things that we have to take into account as the planning function of our commission. And the answer is not always have developers build an unlimited number of parking spaces, because those parking spaces are taking away functional land. So there are trade-offs. You know, they can raise, you know, they can buy a property next door, you know, build another 10 spaces, and then we lose, you know, however many residences, which is taxable land. The paved, you know, parking lots are not doing anything for our tax base. And it's going to encourage more cars in the neighborhood. So if we want to get things under control and try to be smart about this, the answer is not continue building extra parking lots or parking garages that we don't necessarily need.
It's to manage it smartly, parking permits, if the demand actually called for it, metered parking and paid permits, possibly annual parking. I will say for the applicant themselves, it is definitely something to consider, parking permits for your residences. Last time I did ask you if you were had any considerations to split rent and parking. That is a potential strategy, but even if you don't split the rent and parking, you can still issue parking permits to your residences to make sure you allocate spaces. So there is something, there is certainly something that they can do, but again, we have to step back and see our role and the town's role in this, which is we have to be stewards of Thompsonville and stewards of our own property and how we want to manage development, not just this one development, but improve Thompsonville. And for what it's worth, there's two grocery stores within walking range, within a quarter of a mile of this property. You go out half a mile, there's more grocery stores right here on Route 5. Very walkable. I agree that our bus service is leaves something to be desired, but that's another opportunity for us. This is us saying, hey, here's another 100 residences. You know, that's possibly, you know, 100, 150 new Enfield residents that say, hey, that's more demand for our bus system. That can, again, increase that demand. So we can say as a town, hey, look at all these residences who live right by these bus stops. Let's increase bus service and make it so that they don't need to keep buying cars and filling the parking spaces. So, yeah, I again, so just to conclude, again, we got to separate, you know, what's here as well as what we want long term. Thank you.
Well said, Commissioner D'Antonio. I hope those people go back to the YouTube tomorrow morning and listen to your comments as you just did for the last 5 minutes. Thank you very much. Well said. Anyone else on parking? I just have one question. I kind of parking. Could we go back to one of the slides? You had the additional parking slide. I think it was before that. No, the one after this one. Yeah. So basically, this additional parking information was taking in consideration that the train station was already built. Okay. Yeah. This one. I just want to make sure I got that right.
Yes. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's within half a mile of a train station.
Yeah. Okay. So that's considering that the train station is already built. And I think somebody already mentioned that if this project was approved, it probably would be built somewhere along the lines of conjunction at the same time the train station, probably give and take 6 months or so, but in that same timeline. I'm just trying to think about, you didn't envision yourself, if the train station comes about as the state says it will, you didn't envision this building being up 2 years before the train station, I guess is my question.
No, at this point, the actual financing construction schedule would begin in early 2025. The construction wouldn't be complete before 2027. Okay. My understanding is the high-speed rail station is scheduled to begin in spring of 2025. Yeah. I don't know what the construction schedule for that is, but I would expect it would be completed certainly short of 12 months.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to make sure I had that for the record and I got that clear. So I guess I think we can move on from parking, if you want to continue.
I think so, Mr.
Yeah,
Chairman.
Thank you so much. Hope you don't mind us doing it this way.
We're good. Why don't we go to the
way? Hope you don't mind us doing it this way.
Not at all. Okay. Not at all.
Thank you.
It's the commission's meeting, so.
No, actually, it's the town's meeting. It's the residents, too, so. It's all of us. Go ahead.
You know, with the parking, just a couple of quick points. And, you know, if there some neighborhoods, for example, in other towns will have permitting process, right, where residents have permits and they park during the time frames. Again, the parking information that we've utilized from ITE demonstrates with existing data throughout the country that we're not going to have an issue. That's why we generated that for you. And again, as Commissioner Antonio indicated, and I said three times maybe already, that we do comply with your regulations relative to that. But, you know, when you have a walkable neighborhood, which is everything that I've read between river studies and your purpose that's in your regulations, and they go hand in hand, The idea is to promote a walkable community and to maintain that in Thompsonville. And this does provide boots on the ground, and we have actually hard data relative to the uses that we're talking about. And as far as a parking garage, although my client would certainly be interested in working with the commission, this proposal in and of itself is a public-private partnership. This is classic. This is what you read about in planning school, in development in towns, economic development, and that's what's being provided. In addition to housing opportunities, we walk through the POCD recently adopted and your affordable housing plan recently adopted, and how this does promote this. As far as additional cars, we just bought a place in Denver. It's a mixed-use, mixed-income community. It's walkable, and my car is here when I come back for work. And my wife said, leave the car here because we don't need it. We only need one car. There are times there's a neighborhood Target. There's a grocery store. There's all sorts of shops within walking distance of where we are. And this was built. It's an old airfield called Lowry. And it's, I don't know, maybe 100-fold what we're talking about here, but it's the same concept. And you need the residences in there, otherwise you're not going to be able to support the businesses that are in the neighborhood. But I can just tell you from my personal experience that it works, and I'm living in one of those situations now. And when looking for an apartment here after we sold our home, if I wasn't going to have a parking space, one parking space, I just went, you know, we just went to another apartment because there's apartments around here where you can find one. So I think that, again, I think that parking is always a concern, and it's a legitimate concern. I think we made a sincere effort to try to generate hard data for the commission. It's probably similar, and the concepts are similar to what you heard from your consultants and what you thought about when you were drafting regulations for this district. So again, we're trying to meet your regulations and work with them and to work with you and the town. Because again, this is a true public partnership, public-private partnership. My client with the town of Enfield. So I just wanted to. That kind of covers a lot of other things I was going to say in the conclusion. But I thought this was an appropriate time with the parking issues. So I'll turn it over to Mr. Vaca, who will address the stormwater.
Yep, please again, proceed.
Thank you.
Again, for the record, Frank Vaca from BSC Group, professional engineer. There were some concerns brought up with regard to some of the stormwater associated with our low-impact development design, utilizing the focal point systems as a way to treat the water as opposed to the standard catch basins and detention pond setup. One of the concerns being because this star, which represents the high point on the site, directing the flow away from those high point areas, that there was a concern that some of these flows would ultimately encroach onto adjacent properties. To explain a little bit more about how the focal point works is as the flow enters the system, it basically ponds in the grassed area here and filters down into a storage area. But in those situations when there are larger storm events, in 25 or 50-year storm events where there's a substantial amount of water, the black grate that you see represented here is our emergency overflow discharge. This discharge is intended to basically pass all of the water that no longer needs to be treated directly into the storm system and off the site. The design of this, the elevation of this basin, and it's hard to represent on this plan, but this graphic, the elevation of this will be set such that in the event of any of these storms, there will never be a condition where the stormwater will, there will always be 1 foot of freeboard from the far edge of the structure to that emergency overflow. To further illustrate that point, this is an urban condition, but what I'm trying to implement through this photo is this larger wall that's represented right here. At the time that these structures are constructed, there is further, we have the ability at that time to further elevate the far edge of these basins in those areas of concern to ensure that there is no overtopping of this onto adjacent properties. And our stormwater design, which has been reviewed by the town engineer, verifies the fact that this will pass those higher level storms without breaching any of these. Are there any questions with regard to stormwater?
Could you go back to the prior slide? So I take it that that drainage system's only in those, I'm sorry.
No, it's a glare.
Oh, okay.
I'm just,
that's all right.
I can't
please.
See.
That's all right. I take it, and if this drainage system's only in place in those two areas that are blue on the schematic?
Yes, that's correct. So there are three identified, so the three blue areas, right,
yeah.
Identify this. Obviously, I didn't focus as much on this one because this one would over, if it were to overtop, would be into the street. But yeah. Again, there is no anticipation that there would be any overtopping of this. So the flow would basically pass through the pretreatment structure into this area. It would fill up with water and then overtop into this structure and immediately out of sight. And then the other benefit we have at the time of construction, should there ever be a concern, we can over-design it by increasing the size of this structure. So there would, there was not a practical way that this would ever, with the exception of fully clogging the downstream system, which is outside of our control, there would never be a reason for this to back up and overflow.
Was there any consideration to having additional drainage systems such as this stormwater, like on, certainly on the south end, you know, in behind building B or in front of, you know, near parking area?
In other words, increase the number of focal points?
Yes.
There is a possibility they could do that. The way the site layout works, it was ideal for one area to drain in this direction, one area to drain towards Pleasant Street, and one area to drain in this. We can always add additional ones.
Okay.
It just reduces the total all amount of area of water that would get to them. Now, however, in my coordination with the providers of these structures, these are actually a very small amount of area to be treated. The maximum area, actually, the one that's represented right here, and it is less than, I believe it's less than 0.5 acres. And as you could see by the size of the structure, it is not an excessively large structure. It is not anticipated that there's a need for additional ones. This is an ideal use. There are multiple designs that I have been encountered with in regard to these systems where they actually only have one focal point on the site. So.
Okay. Thank you. Commissioner D'Antonio?
Does the stormwater drain study, do they include other landscaping as part of the kind of like worst case scenario? And if not, do you anticipate that the landscaping you'll be providing will kind of act as a supplement for improving drainage and water absorption?
If I could clarify your question, when you say other plantings, could you just clarify what you mean by other plantings?
The proposed landscaping outside of those three drainage areas. So, you know, like immediately adjacent or around the buildings. So do you anticipate that those will provide additional drainage support?
The benefit of all of the plantings associated with the entire development is that through the installation of all the planted areas, there's a certain amount of material that would need to be removed and a certain amount of material that would end up having to be replaced. So all of those areas essentially would function as type of treatment areas. Now, the design of the treatment structures themselves, in particular for the for the parking areas, the plantings identified here as an example, the landscape architects at our office would specifically choose the types of plants that would be utilized to provide the maximum amount of water quality. So it's to absorb nitrogen, to absorb phosphorus, to filter out those sediments that essentially hold on to the heavy metals and the pollutants that are created predominantly from vehicles in our environment. As they wash off, they get trapped in all of these, and then the plants themselves are actually the most ideal form of mechanism to remove these pollutants from the environment, as well as the trees. There was a comment from the town engineer about trees being located too close to these designs. It was actually the intention of the landscape architect to place them as such to further support water quality treatment associated with these products.
Right. Thank you. Yeah, that's more or less what I was getting to. So thanks. Appreciate that.
So if we keep go following that same length, I was going to ask that next question about town engineer mentioning that about the trees planted too close to the Ferguson devices. Has your consultant had that conversation with the town engineer to rectify that opinion or to discuss that?
That is correct. I've responded to all of the comments from the town engineer, and my response specifically to that, I have not spoken to him directly, but my response to that is it was designed this way intentionally for the purposes of stormwater treatment. We do not anticipate the way the design of the system is such, any type of root intrusion associated with the tree is not going to interfere with the way the product functions. In fact, it will benefit the stormwater pollution uptake associated with this stormwater.
Okay, thank you. I haven't seen his reply to that.
Understood.
Maybe I missed it, but thank you.
I would also like to note that just in general, with regard to Commissioner D'Antonio's statements, that we are reducing the overall impervious coverage on the site, therefore detention is not required, and we are further supplementing the areas just through the additional plantings. It's supplementing the water quality for the site.
Yep. Okay, thank you. Questions on drainage? Frank, give me some. Go ahead. You want to finish up?
The only other thing I was going to say is that right now, the current design, I understand that there was some flooding associated with this. These treatment structures intended to prevent any of that from happening in the future. And this stormwater quality that is being represented here will be substantially better than anything that has been provided previous to this. And in fact, to clarify, there is no stormwater treatment associated with any of the previous developments or anything that's currently in existence.
Thank you. Commissioner Lyman, do you want some questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. On an area where the water holds before it reaches the emergency exit, we'll call it.
Yes.
What happens if that freezes up? Like here we get snow on top of rain, rain on top of snow. What happens if that freezes and it won't move?
I wish I had a better picture. The way the product design is beneath this media structure right here, there is about 18 inches of this engineered media. When we say it's engineered media, there's organic material to allow the plants to grow, but there's also a type of synthetic material that is placed to allow for free drainage. And beneath that layer, there is actually a 18-inch to 2-foot deep, basically void that would be capture the water. That void space will be located below the frost line and will never freeze. And as a result of that, through convection, it actually melts the material that's above it. So it is not, it wouldn't surprise me after, and I've seen this before with these designs where after a snowstorm, the first area that melts is the area of the focal point. It's basically it's similar to steam lines on a campus or something like that. Those areas melt prior to the rest of the site.
So the warm water below the frost line generates heat.
Yes.
Comes up and
right.
melts it.
Yes.
That's what you're
correct.
Saying. Wow.
Yes.
Where is the snow going to be packed up?
The snow is proposed. There's a storage area that is immediately upslope of this area, and there's another large area. In total, we're providing approximately 12 to 1,500 square feet of snow storage. The grading associated with these areas basically pitch this area towards the focal point, again, to treat it. And then the edges of this area will be graded in such a way that any of the snow that is stored there basically stay. Any of the runoff from the snow will be collected and directed to the focal point and not onto adjacent properties.
To the heated storm drain. Dumpster pad?
The dumpster pad is located this rectangle. Okay. That's right here, yes.
All right, thank you.
Sure.
And just for Chris Smith, for the record, Mr. Vaca, with the stormwater management, is there currently a stormwater management and quality system that's servicing the properties?
Currently under this design, there is no stormwater system treating the property at this time. There are some existing catch basins on site, but they do not treat any of the water. They essentially discharge directly into the town system. So we would be, number one, reducing flows to the existing system, number two, treating all the flows, getting to the system, and they are all being designed and treated in accordance with the Connecticut standards for stormwater quality.
And specifically, Mr. Vaca, that's the 2004.
The 2004 Stormwater Record. Quality Manual. That is correct.
Just want to be clear for everybody.
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions on drainage? Commissioner Higley?
I just want to make sure I understand this correctly because I'm not very knowledgeable about stormwater. Is all the stormwater generated on your property stay on your property?
The stormwater the only stormwater that exits the property will be that which exits the property through the treatment centers, which would be this focal point represented in blue here, the focal point represented here, and the focal point represented here. They enter this, pass through the media, get treated into a small storage area before being discharged into the town system. So the stormwater on the site does ultimately make its way into the storm system, but it will be a less amount of water than is currently being, that is currently entering now or has entered when the Strand Theater and other impervious structures were in this area.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And Chris Smith, just for clarification, so all the stormwater associated with this site development will be collected and treated?
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions on stormwater or drainage? Seeing none, proceed.
There were some questions at the last meeting regarding the placement of some of the trees associated with the development from Commissioner D'Antonio. We have since gone back. I've coordinated with my landscape architects. We've moved all of the trees at least 5 feet more away from the building. And to just stipulate, the trees that are the most closely associated with the building are going to be the American hornbeam, and the tree that you see is an identification of an American hornbeam. It's more vertical in nature, and it will not grow into the building. And similar to house plants, you know, when trees or something are growing, when a house plant grows next to a window, it grows in the direction of the sun. Similar to trees on the site, they will grow away from the facade because there will be more shade associated with the facade.
And what's the name of that type of tree?
It's the American hornbeam. I don't have the Latin name.
It's okay. Thank you.
Mr. D'Antonio potentially may have the Latin name for you. I would note that, yes, all of the species that are on the site now are native species. There are no invasive species on the site.
Any landscaping questions to follow up? No? Good. Oh.
No, never mind.
All right.
Never mind.
Okay.
Not a landscaping.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Positive.
Let it go.
It's not landscaping.
Let's keep going.
Just to tie into the landscaping discussion, what I know there were prior presentations of the building facade and the rendering associated with the development. What we've added to this is the trees that you see represented here directly correlate to the landscaping plan that has been proposed. What I'd like to point out is that the trees that you see actually planted here would be similar to a just finished, just planted look. So these trees are newly planted. They're only about 1.5 inch to 2 inch caliper trees themselves, probably 20 to 25 feet high. The intent behind this is to show basically the enhanced streetscape look that we are trying to achieve. I know that there were comments in the past regarding the scale of the building, which is why we added one additional rendering to the site to show at full maturity. These would be the approximate height of the trees. So the scale of the building is substantially brought down based on the fact that the streetscape is substantially enhanced with the landscaping that is being provided. I would like to just point out the fact that the understory is more visible, which is similar to the majority of most of the streetscape that is aimed to be achieved for streetscapes of this type. For areas such as this.
Thank you very much. If you could back up a couple slides, I think one of the questions we had on this, maybe one more even. No, maybe it was too far. Yeah, that's fine. Is the fact that, if I'm not mistaken from the last presentation, the offices that satisfy the mixed use requirement are going to be in building B, correct?
They will be in building A. They are the ones that are located in this photo right here. Yes.
So I understand those types of windows on the ground floor, but then when you look at building the other building, then, which is now not going to have any mixed use, please remind us or enlighten us again as to why we still have those, what I would say, commercial type windows.
Yeah, why don't we do one?
Oh. In your rendering, anyways.
Hi.
Is that working?
Hello?
No, it's not working.
Okay, try again.
There we go.
Okay. Susan O'Dell, Paul Bailey Architect, for the record. The use of the storefront windows is exclusively for the office areas and the common spaces in Building B, so that you can see greater activity through those windows. So the common room and the exercise room will give the look of a, you know, of an occupied active space.
Okay.
And it separates them distinctly from the residences that do occupy part of the first floor, which have the more traditional double-hung windows.
Which I see now on the north end of that building. Yes. Right. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for the explanation. Any questions on this part of the architectural design? Anyone? Commissioner DeGray.
I spent the last 2 weeks riding around Thompsonville. I've lived in Thompsonville. Grew up in Enfield. And the thing that disappoints me about your design is there's no, when we're driving, you're driving down Main Street, you're seeing nothing but windows. There's no welcoming front entrance. And in New England, that's a big deal to us. Our town hall has one, the fire department has one, the health department has one. The old fire department, hopefully someday will be pizza brewery, I can't wait, has one. I mean, all the buildings have one, and you're basically giving us the back of the building, and then on Building A, that's not even got, doesn't have, sorry, my line, doesn't have a front door either, which doesn't really go with the historical part of Enfield. The Strand had a front entrance. The original building was a police station before it was La Magna. That had a front entrance. The La Magna Center has a front entrance. It breaks up that big, huge wall. I know you've got this design the way that you want it, but is there a way to just turn it around, give us a front entrance? I mean, I think that would be more appealing than what we're seeing on this. I just a suggestion. It's not my money, it's your guys, but that's a big deal to the charm of New England, is everybody has a front entrance. And you basically look at this and you've got two back doors.
So the rendering, the view that you see here does not show Building A entry, but as you're coming down the street, Building A entry is very prominent. When you look into the driveway, you see two entries, actually, one into the residential and one into the office space. Unfortunately, we don't have a view to show you that, but as you're driving down towards the monument, you will see those doors. It's always a challenge with a residential project, to provide the convenient entry that residents need from the parking lot. We chose here to line the street with buildings rather than parking, to hold the street edge and define the street edge.
Can I stop you right there? I'm not asking you to move the parking lot and push the building back.
If you'll just let me finish.
Just flipped it around so that we have a prominent entrance.
So perhaps during when your zoning regulations were rewritten, were design considerations not, you know, in other words, a lot of times that can be a requirement of zoning if it's written into the regulations that the building have a front entry. I didn't see that in your regulations.
I mean, most buildings have a front entrance. When we wrote the regulations, we assume everyone thinks about putting a front entrance on the street. And this
so
looks like
as I said, it's always entrances. A challenge with a residential development. These buildings obviously do have front entries.
They face
the parking
doors.
Areas. I believe Building A's entries are very prominently in view as you drive down the street and look into the development. In terms of flipping, entry control is always a challenge as well. So management teams prefer to have one main entry. I don't can't think of an a project that we've done outside of a zoning requirement to have a door on the street where we've placed a second door on the street because of that, because of entrance control in these multifamily environments. As far as flipping it with one, then if you put that entry on the street, then every resident has to walk from the parking lot all the way around the building to get into that main entry, unless you allow a secondary entry, to which I just spoke about, which is then becomes an additional place for, you know, where you need controlled entry and you need to have eyes on the entry.
I guess that's
the answer to that.
I'm looking at your plans and you have two like exit doors, I'm calling them exit doors, on both ends of that building. The residents could have car key entry into those doors.
So those doors are fire exit only. Our clients never put key card entry into fire stairs, which are what those are, required fire egress.
So if I may?
Go ahead.
Just to sum up, just so we're all on the same page, and I think we quite understand, but I just want to get it in there. Basically, your design has the front entrances pretty much designed inside the area towards the parking instead of outside towards the streets for a variety of very good reasons that you've just mentioned. But that was your decision as the designer and builders to do that,
right,
to consolidate them inside your area instead of outside onto the streets of Church Street or Main or Chapel. Okay.
Yep.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Just one more thing, because we're talking about internal parking, and you've got EV stations. You've only got, I think there was four of them for eight cars. I'm thinking of the future. People are buying hybrids. People are buying electric cars. Are you going to be able, or have you thought already of installing additional lines underground so that you can add more EV stations later on as cars become more popular?
So we are currently meeting the Connecticut regulation.
I understand that, but I'm talking about the future, because today we don't have that many, but in 5 or 6 years, you could have 50% cars that are electric.
If the owner wishes, we absolutely could install conduit underground. We do it all the time.
All right.
It's the owner's prerogative.
I didn't know if that was something you'd do during your immediate construction, and so it would make it quicker and easier and
cheaper.
If the owner requests it, we certainly do.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions about architecture? See, no other questions. Architecture, is there anything else? You guys?
I haven't even presented the architecture.
We did come up with a supplemental, an alternative design that Susan was going to go through as part of that presentation, but certainly field questions at this
point. Just a quick question. The community room in Building B, those are those doors to the outside, are those exit only, so the residents could they exit through the community room but just enter through the main entrance?
So the community room doors open to the patio there, and thank you for reminding me that those are also entry doors that are very prominently seen from the street. But the purpose of those doors is to, when there's a function in the community room, to allow residents to use the patio in association with the room itself. But certainly those... all doors function as egress doors in the event of an emergency. Usually in developments like this, again, there's one point of entry into each building which has a key card controlled access. So those doors on the community room would not have that key card access, mm-hmm. but they certainly are useful during community room events. And of course, always for egress.
Right. Okay. That makes sense, because that'll be a more reasonable exit to the street for residents. So that's still an option for them.
Right, depending on how the management wishes to maintain control of or to the community room.
Right, okay. Thanks for that clarification.
All right, I think we're ready for you to proceed. Go ahead.
Okay, so Frank mentioned that we added the trees to the rendering just to show you guys what it really would look like. To Commissioner Alamo's point, we did look to the history of Thompsonville and based our design on some historic structures in Thompsonville, which actually are on the National Register and recognized as part of the significant history of Thompsonville. So while we do stand by this design and think it is quite appropriate, we also wish to be responsive to public comment. And we certainly acknowledge that this is far from the only design solution. So we wish to show another solution. Is it? Yep. Okay. So, yeah. All right. So there's the original. Here's a revised or alternate design, which I want to say softens the look. We had some very large bays on the building, which we've basically broken down into smaller bays, and we've added architectural detailing and color in panels between the windows to further soften the look and give an alternate option. Of course, we could do this all day. As architects, we like to design. The owner has graciously considered this as a viable option, even though it will be more expensive. You can see more detail, more architectural detail on these buildings that will increase the cost. But the owner, too, wishes to be responsive to the community's thoughts and needs. So we do present this as an option. It involves very de minimis changes to the building footprint, really just... Here we go. Really just a small indent here in that main bay that you saw before to create two bays. No changes to unit numbers or mix in the footprint of the building, and really just aesthetic changes on the face of the building. Over here along the long side of building B, we had two larger bays along the side, which are now broken down into four smaller bays. So each living room in the units receives that bay, pops out a little bit. So very, very small changes to the plans you saw before. And just to show you in plan, there's that little recess that we added to the one large bay to make two smaller. You see that here and here, and that's really the bulk of the change here. And there's no, again, no change to the unit mix or count. Second floor plan shows you the same. The elevations, again, so you are looking at, this is the entry that I referred to earlier as it will be very prominently seen as you drive down the street. When you look into the driveway of the complex, you'll see that entry canopy and identify that as an entrance. That is the main entrance to Building A. The other two elevations of Building A, there you can see. So if I'm standing straight at the street, looking straight at this building, there's my entry canopy right there. It's very prominently seen from the street, and I apologize, we didn't have a great rendering view to demonstrate that. So again, Building B, we created the little recess to break down the bulk of the larger bay into two smaller ones. Along this facade, we previously had two larger bays, which are now broken down into four smaller ones. Same thing happens over here with the little indent to break down the bay. Same thing is happening above. Again, no change to unit mix or unit count. And here we are, Church Street elevation. With the four smaller bays, with different architectural detailing at the roof line, and the addition of colored panels between windows that was not previously seen. So, And as you're driving down, I believe it's Chapel, you will see prominently this entry for Building B in the site, because it, you can see it's a projected overhang. So it's, it will be pretty obvious where that door is. Yeah, and there's the view of it straight on. So I believe, yeah, this is the last slide, right? With the trees, with the mature trees at the alternate design. And we thank you.
If I, I just have a quick question. Susan, with the design that's, the initial design that we submitted with this application, not the alternate, the other one, I know I was not involved in this process, but my understanding was there was another property that triggered SHPO's involvement with the historical components that was raised by Commissioner Alamo? Alimo, I'm sorry, Commissioner Alimo. And maybe if you can just explain that a little bit to the commission and public, that you did spend quite a bit of time to incorporate historical components with the initial application. But after we heard the comments from some of the public and the commissioners on the hearing on the 16th of November, we came back with this alternate design. And my client is, it's more costly, so to speak, with the second design, the alternate design. But if that's something that the commission would favor, my client is certainly willing to do that. But I was hoping that Susan could just explain a little bit of the effort from your group, your company, to incorporate those historical components for, and to get the SHPO sign off.
Right. So we did at some one point require SHPO to the State Historic Preservation Office to review and approve the design. No longer a requirement based on the changing footprint of our property, but here we are. The outline is most clear here in this bay of the worker housing, the outline of the worker housing that we chose to emulate. If you drive down Pleasant Street past our property, there is a strong line of those worker housing buildings that were built and are part of the National Historic Register and are recognized as significant structures in Thompsonville and significant parts of the history of Thompsonville. We found that to be a very compelling image and outline, and chose to use it in breaking down the bulk or the mass of a multifamily building. We chose to use that profile. It is very muscular in comparison to some other multifamily buildings you have seen. So we get that, and that's why we provided the alternate. But we felt it was a very strong, compelling image, and it related directly to the history of Thompsonville. And the SHPO was very much in favor of this building design, which we didn't change. We just, there was a third building that faced Pleasant Street that we no longer have. But the design was exactly the same that you see here. So we felt that it was a very strong and way to reference and honor, frankly, Thompsonville. But we get that it that it's a, you know, more strenuous design than you might be used to seeing.
You want to see muscular, you should have went down Cottage Green. You want to see, I don't know if you've been down there, you've saw the same types of houses there. So it's pretty familiar in the Thompsonville area. A lot that got torn down in the 70s, but you're not wrong with your analysis.
Okay.
Any questions? I think I'd like...
You want to respond? A question?
Well, or I think that, to be honest with you, the public's been sitting a long time. Can we?
I just wanted to follow up on the architectural effect.
Sure, go ahead. Good.
Yeah, so maybe you misunderstood, and I appreciate your research, and you picked out the housing more residential. I say the residential areas where there was no mixed use. I was referring to North Main Street, Pearl Street, the gateway into Thompsonville, when I was saying to bring it back. That's what I was referring to. That does represent the housing, but not the mixed use that was primarily all along North Main, Pearl, Main. That's what I meant. Thank you.
So I think I'm going to pause now. We're going to take the public comment. You guys can leave a lot of your stuff in here. You're going to come back, but I'm going to let the public.
So we'll leave all the chairs, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah,
it took us a while to set up and
started. Please.
So, but we'll leave them, and we can circle back after we hear from the public. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Frank, do you want me to wait to...
No, you can start public. Good.
Okay, you sure?
Here you go.
Okay. Thank you, Frank. Okay, we'll hear from the public part of this public hearing. We have Jeff and Angela Foss. I'm not sure if you want to come up together. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. Okay. I think you know the routine.
This time.
Yeah, you know the routine, so I don't need to instruct you.
Oops. Yes. Jeffrey Foss, 16 Crescent Beach Drive, Enfield. So I'm here in opposition of this project, and I'm going to tell you why. First of all, I just want to say a couple things that was mentioned that there's no track records of parking in the area. Well, I actually owned property for 34 years in Thompsonville, and the track record is me. I have 14 buildings surrounding this property, including the four properties, if you bring up the picture that had the whiteout section that I'm sure everybody's familiar with, those are my four buildings that touch this project. The stormwater is a big concern. They talked about the runoff on the surface, but what they didn't talk about is what's going to happen below the surface. So my four buildings that are up against this property all have full foundations. Those are old 130-year-old foundations. And as you know, water seeks its easiest path. So this system they have drains down into the water. It utilizes the dirt. The dirt eventually leads to my basement areas. And I guess my big question is, who am I supposed to sue when my basements fill up with water? Would it be the town or the developer? Because my basements are full of my heating systems and my electrical systems. So I can tell you right now that those foundations are very sensitive. And this is right up against it. All the water is leading to my four buildings. Now I'm going to go on and read what I have to say and explain everything. Do not approve this project for Thompsonville as presented. The grant money was already denied by the town council. I have 45 signatures on a petition with most people within 500 feet border. I have 14 buildings, 66 families surrounding this project. Everybody I asked agreed 100% with the petition to deny this project. Reason number one is parking. What do you think will happen when there's 40 to 70 more cars in the streets? Now, I come up with a number a little bit higher than their 41 because what they're not factoring in is birthday parties or guests coming over to visit these people. There's going to be, with 70 additional families, there's going to be more than just the 41 cars. They're not factoring that in. Almost every other week, I receive calls from my tenants fighting over street parking. Already, I have tenants attacking each other's cars over somebody parking in their street parking spot. You're going to have riots in the streets, basically, if these guys come in, because there's nothing available right now. Absolutely nothing. 12 of the parking spaces they're talking about in the municipal parking lot, that's the one across from Corona's, is already taken over by the six family at the end of that parking lot. The town gave those 12 spots for that six family to utilize. So that can't even be calculated properly the way they did it. This parking lot is not within 500 feet of the project either. If you go out and check it, it's not within 500 feet. It's over. Where are the customers of Sylvia's restaurant on the corner of Chapel supposed to park? Sylvia's restaurant is right next door and right next to my properties. My properties are 15 units. Using your calculations, I need 30 parking spots just for my people. And I can tell you that several of my tenants have three cars. They don't just have one car. Some of them have three. They have a work truck, a regular car, and then they have a family member who needs an additional car. So parking is already way over the top. In the winter, nobody can park on the streets. So where are they going to put all of those extra cars, plus the cars of people visiting? Virginia mentioned exactly the point. That parking lot that was for the town pool parking gets maxed out usually when there's no place to park during the winter. It gets full. They're going to consume that now for their parking area. It's gone. So that eliminates a whole group of parking for those people that live around there. I can tell you what happens to my properties. My yards get parked on. The front yards, the grass, they actually park on it when this happens because there's no place for the cars to go. Now, that's currently. Impact Residential doesn't care about the neighborhood or the parking situation or the abutters, which I am. They just want to put as much housing into the smallest piece of land for the least amount of money. This does not add value to the neighborhood. Reason number two, I spoke with John Cabibo, the town engineer. He was not aware that my four properties have full basements, and the electrical and the heating are in the basements. These foundations are 130 years old and fragile. Claims were made by Impact at the last planning and zoning meeting that the town engineer had signed off and approved this. I spoke with him directly. He has not. He still has a list of unanswered questions. To top this off, they want to pile up the snow right along my properties. Where will the snow go?
Jeff, excuse me. Your 5 minutes is up. You can come back a second
absolutely.
Time.
Absolutely. I'm done right here. Anybody want to guess where the snow's going to go? I'll be back. Thank you.
Do you have a petition?
I do have a petition, but I wanted to read it first before I submit
it. Okay, you can come back a second
so when
time.
I do the second half.
Yep.
Thank
no
you.
Problem. Ms. Foss?
Good evening, Planning and Zoning Commission. It's nice to be back. I know that I'm definitely going to go over, so you just let me know when I need to stop. Do not approve this project. It does not comply with zoning regulations for Thompsonville or for Enfield. I just read today, under the general conditions, number 5, that they have 14 years to complete this project. 14 years. That's a long time. I'm very thankful to the town council that they are not supporting this project with a vote on December 4th of 9-2 against. I'm very hopeful that you will agree with them. As direct abutters, we would have attended the previous PNZ meeting, but were not informed of it. There are signs posted without any meeting dates or details. So I watched the video on YouTube and saw our properties presented as these big white blocks. And I saw them talking about our four buildings and our 15 families and realized our full basements were in jeopardy. At the town meeting, town manager Bromson stated about parking is a very, very troubling issue there. And here he is, handsome man that he is. And he's talking about the plan, the original plan, which is beautiful, about how there was going to be a parking garage, and there was going to be a small apartment building with 40 to 44 apartments. And look at the green space. See that big green space? That's there because somebody researched the fact that there can't be anything there right abutting to our properties. Our properties are right here. And they have this cute little idea of a coffee shop and restaurant space. That's a mixed-use building. These buildings aren't mixed-use buildings. He and the staff went on to explain the original vision created by these two amazing students at UConn. And the picture in the design is a mixed-use building. U.S. commissioners know the zoning requirements inside and out, so I am sure that you are well aware of all the zoning regulations that they have not met. But I will point out a few that I noticed in my research as a layperson. I will give this to the staff. Page 9 in your zoning regulations. Zoning introduction explains the purpose of zoning is to lessen congestion in the streets, to prevent overcrowding, and to avoid undue concentration of population. That are the minimum requirement. Page 18, mixed use is a building with commercial uses on the bottom floor and residential above. These plans show apartments on the first floor, therefore it is not a mixed use building. Page 22, conformity of buildings, heights, yards, area, basically states that this new structure must comply with the same footprint and the height of the previous existing buildings. Page 103, protect the unique historical and natural features built upon the historic function of Thompsonville's retail. No retail here. Frontage and rear yards, there are none. Page 104, lot and area requirements, are they met? Page 108, again, since this does not meet the requirements of a mixed-use development, then it does not belong in Thompsonville, and or more parking is required. If it did meet the requirements, their math is still way off. They plan for 2 studio units, that's 2 spaces. 27 one-bedroom units, 1.5 spaces are required for a one-bedroom in the T-bill regs. That's 40 and a half spaces. 41 two-bedroom units, that's 82 spaces. Office space is 6 spaces. Total spaces required, 132. That is 21 spaces more than they have listed. Minus the 76 they have planned for, they are required to have 56 more on-site parking spaces. And that is not considering, they've mentioned it, but they haven't added this in, the community room, which they plan to rent out for parties. What are the additional parking requirements for this? They need to add a parking garage, as the original design shows. Or they can build an apartment building with about one-third the units and sufficient on-site parking. But according to table 10.10.2 on page 123, conversion to residential use, it requires 2 parking spaces for each dwelling unit. Let me know. Am I done?
Your time's up, Andrew.
Okay, thank you.
I think you're going to come back.
Yes, I am.
Patrick Thibodeau? Patrick, would you mind if I stood up for a little bit?
No.
I got to stand up.
Hello. Patrick Thibodeau, 20 Cora Street, Enfield. I fully support this project. So what happened in Thompsonville in the early 1970s? Because that's the pertinent period. Bigelow was shutting down. Thompsonville residents began shopping at the malls like everybody else. And as retail stores closed, the Strand Theater started showing porno. Bigelow was an exception in development, but it acted like an island where people went there and parked and left and really didn't participate in Thompsonville. So what was the end result of all of this? Investment stopped. We know from numerous studies that the town has done that over this period of time, there was a high rate of absenteeism, landlordism, and disinvestment. I'm quoting that from a 2009 study of the town. A more recent survey by Gorman York, the consultants of the plan on the conservation and development, housing quality was a top issue. Absentee landlords who haven't improved their properties or charge high rents risk losing their best tenants to impact residential. So I would argue that one of the major issues here has nothing to do with parking, has everything to do with housing competition. This is a disruptive project that is a threat to existing landlords. But in a way, that's a pretty good thing. Because if impact residential is successful, other investors may be encouraged to act. And we may begin to see condo conversions and reduce the percentage of housing that is rental. That's the thing I would put to you. What is the biggest problem in Thompsonville right now? Is it parking or is it disinvestment? As Mr. Alimo pointed out, not a lot happened over 40, 50 years. And that is the problem. And nothing's going to happen if you turn this down. This is the first big, real significant investment that really attacks two core issues for our community in a very long time. And if this isn't built, I don't know what's next. Because if I lived in Washington, D.C. for 25 years, and let me tell you, and I lived in some of the most highly dense areas that city has. And I'll tell you how they deal with parking and snow and all this. One, when it snows, they plow your car in. And our streets were as narrow as the streets in Thompsonville, and maybe even narrower. They just plow it in. You go out, you dig your car out. They give residential parking stickers. You may not park. Our 40-unit building only had spaces for 11 cars, and they were all tied to the condos. All the buildings are like that. But what Washington did, and what a lot of cities do, is they go ahead and they maximize every single on-street space they can. They don't kid around. If they can put a car there, they put a car there, they put lines in there. People get residential stickers, and as long as you have that residential sticker, you can park anywhere. So there shouldn't be fights or riots in the street or anything crazy happen because there's order and organization to this. And it works. The system works. And there are limits to what a cities allow because they look at cars as cars. Car storage. What is the responsibility of a city to provide or a community to provide car storage? If you want Thompsonville to actually become a thriving community with retail, if you want to return to something of the walkable thing, then you have to think about car parking differently. You have to think that, okay, so we don't have lots for cars in the winter. Just plow them in. People will dig out. It works. it will absolutely work. And when I look at the big Thompsonville Firehouse on North Main Street, and I look at the football field length clearance, where no parking is allowed around that firehouse, I wonder why. Because I go to Middletown, and you know, a couple times a year to meet my friends, and their firehouse is on Main Street, and they have vertical parking, not horizontal, almost right up to the firehouse, where my grandmother lived on Park Street in Hartford, one of the most densest populated areas in the state. They have parking on both sides. There's only two lines for traffic. I mean, it works in every city, in every town, in every place you find firehouses surrounded by parking. We have on-street parking. We have plenty of it, and we can make it available if the town puts its mind to it. I just want to talk about the retail for 1 second. Everybody wants retail, right? But what kind of retail do you think you're going to get? Look at the plaza that's right next door to the lot in question, right? It has a place of worship, it has a salon, and it has a nutrition store. All good uses. I'm not picking on them at all. But what people want in walkable areas, what people wanted in the areas where I lived in anyways, were things that felt like an extension of your living room. Coffee shops, bookstores, places that, you know, with big long tables where you can sit communally, couches, they look like a scene out of Friends. People love those things. I don't really think Enfield can get those things without the town participating. Some communities go ahead and they offer grants, they offer financing, they pay for the furniture, they do all types of creative things to get stores in there. And you can do that right now.
I mean, time's up.
Okay.
You can come back. Do you want to come back?
Okay, yeah.
Christine, I think it looks like Christina Lang.
That's right.
Yep.
Do I press this?
Yes, you have to, for the record, your name and address, please.
Christina Lang, 90 South Road, Enfield. I don't have a very long talk here. I'm just wondering.
You don't have to hold it.
Oh.
It's all right.
Thank you. Good. I wonder how far back we want to go and how long we want to act like doing nothing's okay. I know change is not really easy, but putting off housing forever is horrible. Putting off partnerships means, like I've heard before, that the investment environment of Enfield's like mud. Stick in the mud, I think they meant. You don't want to say no all the time. You want to start building by saying yes. Also, are you going to wait till you have the bus system before you start anything? Are you going to wait till you have somebody building your parking garage somewhere before you do anything about these housing opportunities? Why did the town knock down the theater and knock out La Magna if you didn't want to get something done in a couple of years? I'm not just looking at you. I'm thinking of the town council and how they pulled out the rug a couple of days ago. Pretty disgusting as far as I'm concerned. Winter parking is horrible. I agree. But so, this is supposed to be a transit-oriented district, meaning you're supposed to start getting used to more busing, more trains. So start planning and thinking about why the car isn't the most important thing and how you're supposed to regulate it. The folks who own property in Thompsonville already who aren't managing their parking problems are spilling over on the new people's problems now. So the folks who are complaining about parking who already own property there need to manage their tenants better. I know it's not easy. Believe me, I know. But nothing is easy when you're doing something new and necessary. You have a lot of people who need affordable housing in this community. I just wonder where the vision is. I really wonder. I hear the reasons against, but where's the power of the reasons for? Thank you.
Thank you. I have Patricia Bevins, I think it's Bevins, and Gabby. And I'm sorry if I'm trying to look at this writing here and if I mispronounced.
Mr. Burns and Gabrielle Burns.
Okay, yep, Burns. I'm sorry. Yeah. It was a U. Yep, thank you. Yeah. Sorry
I'm
about
a
that.
Very long time resident of Thompsonville.
You need to disidentify yourself just for and your address, if you don't mind. Your name and address, please.
16A Windsor Street in Thompsonville.
Okay, and you're Patricia?
Patricia.
And you're Gabby.
Gabrielle Burns.
Yeah, okay, please, go ahead.
I have lived there for almost 38 years. Before that, it was 6 Gorman Avenue, the one that burnt there.
Good.
In Thompsonville.
Yeah.
You're not, press the button.
Button, please.
Hello?
There we go.
Okay. As far as our parking, there are some tenants that have places to park and choose to drive, park in the street, on the side of the street. I have lived in Gorman Avenue for years. Yes, there are some places that you can't, but where there's a will, there's a way. We also have people that have 80 million cars that don't move and don't work, so they can't park their new car or newer car. Yes, a lot of our buildings are very old, and I understand what he's saying, that a lot of them are ready to fall apart. But there's a lot of upkeep that needs to be done by many landlords. You can buy a property, but you got to keep it up. I live in one that should be condemned. So yes, if something does happen, the whole thing is going to go. That's why our buildings burn down like that. We do need something for the average working person. I have no assistance. I pay my rent. I pay my bills. My daughter goes to work. I go to work. I walk to work right now, and I walk home. I work in a daycare now. I used to work at Amazon when I had the use of one of my patients' cars to go to work when my car broke down. So I've always worked hard. Most of my children have moved out of town because we don't have anything here. My son, who is in a wheelchair, lives in Windsor Station. There's a train station and there's almost no parking there. My daughter, who works in New Jersey, just sold her car because it's like with a lot of neighborhoods that are even downtown Hartford. You can walk to everything. A lot of people I know that live there sold their cars. To me, that's what the future is coming to. And as far as these electric cars we're going to plug in, let's think of who can afford them. With the price of everything going up, who's really going to be able to afford? And I work in a daycare. People are having less and less children because of the amount of money that it costs to have a child. I'm not saying that people aren't getting married and aren't having children, but the amount every family is having is becoming less. So to me, this would be an added thing because it would give people like me that work hard to live in a beautiful place versus one that is falling apart. And I'd be willing to help both ends. And I have fought here many years ago when we did the restructuring of the school system because I have a handicapped son and Stowe School that the children can play in Prudence Crandall Playground. And I fought until it was taken care of. I'm not one to walk away. You're going to see my face until this is over.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
John Malinowski.
John Malinowski, 1302 Bigelow Commons. It's interesting. The last speaker must have read my mind because I was going to start with saying that one of the favorite things my grandmother used to say to me was, and it was always something I didn't want to do, she'd look at me and she'd say, John, if there's a will, there's a way. Now, this also applies to Thompsonville. This is an opportunity to spur some development in Thompsonville. It's an opportunity to provide affordable housing. The parking issues are just another reason to deny affordable housing to those who desperately need it. The parking requirements prescribed by zoning regulations only serve to drive up the cost of the development, and they do not factor in that this is a transit-oriented development. I have a question to ask. What's more important to a person in need of affordable housing? A parking space or a roof over their head and a safe place to live? Think about how many people in the new community might actually prefer to walk, bike, or catch a train instead of relying on a car. Denying affordable housing because of strict parking rules holds our town back from becoming more diverse and limits options for how we move around and connect with other places. This development should have no problem attracting people to live there. The firm who is responsible here, to me, seems reputable and motivated to do the best job they can for this town. Please do not deny this opportunity we have to create a safe place to live for people who desperately need it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Jeffrey Foss for a second time. 3 minutes, Jeff.
See if I can do it in three. Jeffrey Foss, 16 Crescent Beach Drive, Enfield again. Where I left off, they have planned a drainage system, including the snow piles along the backside of my buildings. Water runoff from the current project is projected to go in the direction of my four properties that are bordering this project. And again, they talk about the surface water, not what's going on below the surface. And the watershed is planned to go between my four buildings with the full foundations. There's a section that goes right through between the buildings. It's all headed my way without consideration, and I'm totally against all the planning and zoning regulations. Let's see. Reason number three, the look of the building. Well, we've already beat that horse, so I'm not going to go there anymore. But I want to say that I have 14 buildings surrounding the project, and quite a few of them are solid brick, which is, I see they have a little bit of brick on the bottom, but maybe we could run some brick up the face to improve things. I need to get to this part. The petition has to do with parking. We, the undersigned, are opposed to the application of impact residential development on a North Main Street, Thompsonville, Connecticut, as submitted with insufficient parking. The roads in this section of Enfield are already overcrowded, as there are not enough spaces for current residents. There certainly is not enough room for new residents. As it is, when the demolition of the Angelo LaMonica Center and the Strand Theater was occurring, the people parking in the immediate area had to remove their cars from the roads, and the town provided temporary window passes to park at the Bigelow Commons since there is insufficient on-street parking available. There is no on-street parking allowed during snow days. Where will everybody park? We call on the town council to not sign the grant money, which they didn't, for this development, to put the complex to allow this complex to go in with insufficient parking. So I'm going to submit this. There's 45 signatures here, and these are people that are surrounding that building. And that's basically all I have to say for now. I'm concerned about two things. One is, where's the water going to go? It's going to look for its easiest path. And the second thing is parking. I have buildings that don't have parking lots. There's just no place to put a parking lot. The buildings don't have room for it. So the people have to park in the streets. It's already been used. The streets are already being fully utilized. Thank you.
Thank you. And you can submit that to staff, please, your petition. Thank you. Angela Foss, for a second time. 3 minutes, Angela.
Yes. Okay, so I was at the point where I said that they needed 140 spaces. Really, we're required 2 parking spaces per each unit. Then you add on 6 for the office space and whatever would be needed for the community rentals, and on and on and on. I'm sure that others of you realize that the numbers were skewed. If there's a reason, if there's a way that they can add a better parking situation on this land, we have nothing against this. We really don't. It's just not following the zoning regs, and we just can foresee down the road that there'll be some serious problems. I would ask you that you also please stop taking results as presented by a developer. Their numbers are changing every time they present them. Have you ever been presented with a traffic study showing that the increase in traffic is a problem or causes a negative impact? I'm sure the answer is no. These hired representatives are hired for that reason, to make the numbers work. We need to have independent reviews. The building design that the town manager agrees with, and so do I, had only 40 units and a parking garage. Page 109, conformity to scale, incorporating historical architectural elements is essential. Page 110 continues with details like cornice design, wrought iron fences. Page 111, preserving the original architecture of the Strand Theater, referring to historic photos. Window sashes, modern window styles are only allowed to be used in the rear of a building. Vinyl siding is discouraged. This whole building is vinyl sided. Public amenities, they don't meet their requirements for public amenities. Landscaping standards haven't been met on page 113. Lighting is mostly against our property. That's not in line with the regs. The garbage is definitely inadequate. 6 yards of garbage for all those people. I don't see our names on the adjacent as adjacent owners on the site plan as required. The stormwater shown and the watershed shown to go directly towards our buildings. Here's the picture I have. Here are our buildings, and here's the watershed. The word watershed right here, going right through between the building spaces. It just makes no sense to me. I'm surprised that they've gotten it this far, but I do want to ask you to please deny this, and the reason being that it's just not following your regs, and you have regs for a reason. And I thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
3 minutes, Patrick.
Pat Thibodeau, 20 Cora Street. You're being told that parking is a problem, right? Okay. What you're not doing is looking at the problem. And this is a problem that the town can solve. And that's really the disconnect here. Your power is really limited. You're going ahead and you're saying, you're just looking at this project, you're hearing the complaints, but you're not thinking through the big picture. I think you could probably put 100 to 200 cars on North Main Street alone. I think if the town went through every single inch of North Thompsonville, or Thompsonville generally, it could probably find additional on-street parking. But the town has to take those steps. If the town doesn't do that, none of this happens. It sounds like from your questions, you're getting ready to kill this project. I really hope that isn't the case, but I'm very concerned about what you may do here. Because if you kill this investment, exactly what investment won't you strangle? You have to ask yourself that. What won't fit your criteria based on everything you heard tonight? You know, the problem here is a town council sitting on its butt, to be honest. They need to get involved with this in a very serious way. They need to deal with the retail issue. They need to be involved in that. They need to deal with the parking issue. They have to get involved with that. And they have to ask essential questions like, what is the state of disinvestment in Thompsonville, and how do we turn that around? And if we don't look at those big macro pictures, then nothing will change. And nothing has changed in 50 years. Look, and plus, let's just consider the demographics. I know you're all familiar with the demographics because you just went through the plan of conservation and development. But you have to ask yourself, how much of that is due to zoning in this community? How much of that is done the bad decision making? And in terms of the rental situation in Thompsonville, don't we want condo conversions? Don't we want to see some beginning of gentrification there? One investment begets other investments. This is investment that might spur other investments. Maybe the landlords who have brick buildings will look at those differently and say, maybe we should convert some of these to owner-occupied housing. You start doing that, things change. You get a better community. You know, you get things are just get different. And, you know, I don't know why this is so hard. I hope it's not the affordable housing. I really hope we've gone past that. I mean, the Felician Sisters was a colossal mistake. But, you know, this town has a history since the mid-80s of killing affordable housing for working families. And I hope that that is not the case here. I implore you to think about the macro issues here and think about the investment, but also think about the people who this project will help. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just want to make sure that anybody else who hasn't spoken at all wish to come up. Seeing that, the applicant come back up here. Seeing that, the public participation part of this tonight's public hearing is closed, so applicant come back up and address any of the questions or concerns that might have been raised by the residents. So again, I'm not sure if you heard anything at this point that you'd like to reply to that you heard from the residents. Maybe you're not ready to reply back tonight, and that's fine too. I mean, however you want to handle it. You did hear some concerns from the residents. I don't know if you want to take it back and digest or whether you want to.
For the record, Chris Smith. No, Mr. Chairman, I think we're prepared. I don't think we heard anything that we didn't think we might hear, especially from the Fosses, I believe,
yeah.
Who own, as they've indicated, a number of properties with yeah. rentals adjacent, yeah. Who would be competitors, so to speak, yeah. or my client would effectively be a competitor. So, but I do think there were some technical issues that were raised yeah. With stormwater
yeah.
and parking compliance. We respectfully submit that we do satisfy and comply with this commission's regulations concerning those. You have a staff report that's pretty comprehensive and walks through those items. But I would like to, at the outset, have Mr. Vaca, our engineer, respond to some of the questions or comments that we heard. Not so much sure. questions, just comments.
Yeah, absolutely.
Check, is this working? Okay, very good. A few of some of the comments in particular, one for the stormwater with concern to above versus below ground. One item that I did not directly address associated with the focal point systems is there is underground storage directly associated with those features. They can be run in two different ways. There's number one, they can be utilized for groundwater infiltration. So based on, without boring the commission, in order to get these systems to be installed correctly, we would have to perform boring test pits. So basically, they drill holes in the ground and they determine the quality of the material that is beneath to determine whether it is capable of being infiltrated, if the water can be infiltrated down into the ground or if it cannot be. As a result of these test pits and as a result of the adjacent uses, including properties, we could make the determination to, instead of infiltrate any of the water, it would be fully encapsulated in the detention system and discharged directly to the associated storm system. We meet all of, and I just like to reiterate, we meet all of the requirements of the town of Enfield zoning regulation and the stormwater regulation with regard to this. I have conveyed this and spoken this with the town engineer, John Cabibo. He did not provide an approval to this, but I have responded to all of his comments. We are able to achieve all of his comments that he specifically requested of us. So I just to reiterate, though there is the potential to not have any infiltration of our systems horizontally out of the drain towards any of the adjacent properties.
So if I can sum it in a layman's mind here, I'm thinking of like a septic system. One way would be where I had a septic system where things were seeping into the ground. Another way would be it's just a holding tank that would be discharged out into our storm drain system in layman's terms.
That is correct. So everything is stored, essentially it's stored like a septic system in layman's terms, and it would discharge, and it does not actually exit the storage area.
Okay.
Again, to reiterate what we have said at previous times, we are reducing the overall stormwater impervious cover. Therefore, the amount of water that is currently flowing on the site will be decreased through the implementation of this design. So there will be less water exiting the site, there will be less water stored on the site and being conveyed into the existing storm system.
Okay.
And all of this design is in accordance with the 2004 Stormwater Quality Guidelines, the 2002 Erosion and Sedimentation Control Guidelines, and all of our designs at BSC Group are in accordance with the DOT Stormwater Manual.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm looking through some other comments. I'd also like to bring, there was one mention with regard to the parking spaces not being calculated correctly. The parking calculation in the regulations does stipulate a 1.5 requirement. However, there has been coordination with the town planning department that has been reduced to one space, and that is due to changes in the state law that happened. I don't have the exact time frame, but it was very recently. So we are in accordance with state law with regard to parking calculations with regard to the TD5 zone where this is located. And again, to reiterate, the entire design, site design-wise and building design-wise, in accordance with the regulations for the Thompsonville TD5 district.
And that parking requirement, so I believe, had state legislature just passed summer, maybe even this past spring. That was the law, a lot of laws that were passed for the affordable housing enactment throughout the state of Connecticut, if I'm not correct.
That was correct.
Public Act 2129.
Thank you very much.
And I have the exact date. It was approved. It was approved on September 11th, 2023 by the Commission of Connecticut's Development and Future.
Thank you. So that's another reason our regulations might not be updated to reflect those new ones. Thank you.
Most towns aren't, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, we're not there yet. I know Lori and the staff are working on it.
But it is the state law. And
supersedes ours. Yep. Thank you for that information. A reminder. Thank you.
Georgie has a question.
I do just want to just reiterate that public act real quick, that our regulations are, they don't include the correct numbers, which we do have to do for our reg amendment rewrite.
Yeah.
But for two bedrooms, the requirement is now only two spaces. One bedroom is one space and a studio is one space.
Right. Okay. Thank you. We wanted to get that for record so everybody understands. Thank you very much.
And Chris Smith, for the record, just again, the parking data and information is generated from the ITE, which is scientific database driven.
I
want to take a moment to we haven't spoken to the quality of building that will be happening here, but a benefit of the funding that will support this development is they have very strict above building code regulations for what we can do. So you'll get some very high quality buildings here. And not only high quality at build out, but they also have regulations to enforce that these buildings will be maintained properly. And so the funding that backs all of this, that enables this project to happen, has so many regulations and requirements that ensure that this will be a high quality property from day one to year 50.
Thank you. So if I can, just want to pause for a second here. We've been going for 2 hours, and do commissioners have any direct questions tonight? And Commissioner Lima, I'll get to you. I figured you would. I didn't mean it as a negative as a sound. I apologize if it came across too negative. I apologize. I just knew you'd have some comments or questions. Does staff have anything they need to
want
tonight?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So.
Just some clarifications on a few things. I'm just going to go in order by the way things were said tonight. So when you were talking about landscaping earlier in the American hornbeam, I do just want to bring to light that in March of 2022, the Conservation Commission had applied for a grant just a little bit down the road for Central Street and High Street, where there was a lack of shade trees. The state awarded the town that grant. We got 21 brand new shade trees for a community that had no trees. This development adds to the trees in Thompsonville. Three of those trees were American hornbeams. The other thing I want to include really quickly is the parking lot location radius from the development. I just measured it on our GIS. It's about plus or minus 345 feet away. It is within that 500-foot buffer. The other thing is Thompsonville has their own.
Which parking lot? Was that the municipal one?
Yes, the municipal parking lot.
So it is within the radius.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Yes, plus or minus, because our aerial is a little bit off by a few feet.
It's okay.
But it's still very much within 500.
Thank you.
The other thing is Thompsonville has their own architectural requirements that are separate than the rest of Enfield. This is specifically laid out in those appendixes. They're not required. They are encouraged, and we always encourage historical architecture for this reason. And it's even more so to point out they have been working with the State Office of Historic Preservation, which is very much in favor of the architectural look this time around. The other thing is we do not define mixed use or require specifically what these uses have to be. Definition 78 mentions all these things, however, it does not require, and it does include office. This also includes restaurant services, recreational, or municipal uses under section 8.123.1. Again, encouraged, not required. The public hearing signs for this application were posted on the property on November 6, 2023, 10 days prior to the meeting. Signed affidavit was given to us by the PE of the project, and those postings were verified. And also, just to go back really quickly to Commissioner DeGray's comment about adding more EV in the future, always down the road, they could always do a modification to include EV stalls if they need more. This is what we just had as an admin approval for a couple other locations in town that wanted to add more EV spaces to their property. And that's all I had. Thank you.
And I think, if I may, before I give it to you, Frank, one of the things I want to mention real quickly is just to emphasize again that this is in a TOD district.
Yes, which our regs do not address yet because it's brand new.
That's brand new. So I just want to make that point again, which things are different than a regular district. This is a TOD district.
Well, exactly. There's one more thing.
The Thompsonville regulations is a TOD development.
Development. Yep.
Guideline and regulation. So that's section 8.12.
Yep.
So it was designed and developed as a TOD development. Yep.
Did you have something else you wanted to add, Lori?
I had one more thing to add.
Sure.
I just verified a lot in bulk information. Everything is satisfied. In fact, it even shows a reduction in impervious coverage from the original 60.8% down to 56. All the setbacks are met, all the frontage is met, and everything else is completely satisfied for the lot and bulk requirements of section 8.121 for TD5.
Just for the record. Thank you. Thank you, Georgie. Okay, Frank.
Thank you. The water runoff that went between the two buildings, the abutters buildings, is there an easement there?
That is, it's current. We call it the flag lot. It is currently going to be owned by the owner of the property because of the shape of the lot. It is currently a driveway, and it is it will be converted to grass. And the typical standard for grass is we account for infiltration for that.
Who owns it now?
It is a private ownership that is under a purchase and sale agreement with the owner.
The Doucettes, correct?
Yeah, that's currently owned by the Doucettes, and there is a purchase and sale agreement in place that's been executed with Impact Residential Development.
And that goes between those two buildings?
Correct. Or the driveway.
The driveway?
To the building behind, which would be part of the proposed parking area for this
specifically that Mr. and Mrs. Foss were speaking about, where the water is going to go between their buildings. That's what I'm talking about.
I think our engineer can speak to the fact that water's not directed between the two buildings there. He just described that it's currently asphalt and will be converted to grass, and all of the runoff will be directed towards the focal points. But go ahead, Frank.
That's correct. And in this case, it will be directed down towards Pleasant Street. It basically will follow the exact condition that it follows now.
But do you control that property where the water's running through? It looked like two buildings. They put up two buildings, two parcels. And the water was coming between two buildings.
Do you want to pull it up?
Yeah, pull up that slide.
Yep, there it is.
So if you want to move your mouse, okay.
This, the area that is shown right there is
goes right out to Pleasant Street?
that doesn't run in this direction. The, anything associated with the property will be directed in this direction. This is currently a paved driveway. It will be converted to grass, and the grading in this direction runs towards Pleasant Street in this area.
And who controls that piece of land that goes between those two buildings?
That will ultimately be controlled by the owner, yes.
And for the record, Frank, if, just to be specific so that the record, somebody reading the record will be able to easily understand what you just said, and I don't know what slide number this is, but if you could make reference to the slide number, and if you can just articulate, like, to the west, in between the two properties located to the west, there's a rectangular strip that goes out to, is that Pleasant?
Pleasant, right.
Sure.
And it is. I can't see that far, but goes out to Pleasant, and yep. that is under contract with the owner, Impact. And we did provide you with an authorization letter from the owners, so that is part of your record.
But the other piece of the question is the water's not running through there, you're saying? It's going around Chapel Street?
I think, Frank, you can explain, you're the engineer, but I think we heard that any of the water collected in the northwesterly corner or part of the property, including the parking area, will be collected, and it's not going that way today, and it won't go that way going into the future. You're going to collect it and direct it to the systems, infiltration systems.
To clarify, the way the grading on this area works is there is a portion of this property identified by my cursor right here, which is on the southern page south side of that small rectangle, will be directed to the focal point, which is located in this location here. Mm-hmm. The grading associated with this parcel runs currently from a high on the south to a low on the north, east. And there is east, in this case it would be east. Yep.
East and west.
And this is currently paved, so the water associated with this runs into Pleasant Street right now. The future condition of this will be grass, and there will be a reduction in the amount of flow that runs towards Pleasant Street. We follow the same drainage pattern here, and there is a net reduction in the entire site, and therefore there is no additional water quality or treatment associated with the flow associated with this piece of the parcel.
So that is part of the runoff.
There is a small
surface runoff.
There is a small component of surface runoff, but it is reduced under this design, and that in the expectation for the industry standard for this is to reduce the runoff discharging from the site.
Okay, thank you for that. The second,
can we follow up on that before we leave that one? Cool. Yeah, you might. So, is it possible for you to upgrade this schematic to show that as a grassed area? And is it possible? And my question, that strip that you're going to buy when it's, since that's part of your plan, because it's kind of not, I think some of us understood that, but it's visually cleared if you made that green. And question for you is, are you going to be putting any type of curbing on the top of that escarpment so that water doesn't go down? I don't know if I'm explaining myself correctly.
Yes, because this area at the very top of that will be utilized for the snow storage and will be shaped in such a way to convey all water. There will be no discharge of water from any of the right. site proper to that piece.
Or as little as possible going down that grassy slope, I guess is my point.
That is correct. The high point of this would be located at the gate right here.
Okay, yep, that'd be fine. That's right, I remember you mentioned there's a gate there.
Yes.
So would it be possible for you to update this schematic going forward to show that as a green area so that there's no confusion going forward?
I think as certainly if the commission were to see fit to approve this, that could be an explicit condition of approval that area be outlined in green and designated as that it will be grassed and going into the future.
Okay.
Frank, just a quick question, Mr. Baca. So in your professional opinion, as a professional licensed civil engineer, will any of the runoff from the site development enter either of those properties, the Foss's properties, I believe, on either side of that strip that abut the subject property, but also abut Pleasant Street to the west?
No, they will not.
Thank you.
Let me just state further on behalf of the owner that if the town engineer determined upon review of plans prior to construction that if additional drainage was required at that point where the driveway now currently enters the site, the owner would be willing to add additional drainage if that was deemed necessary by the town engineer.
Okay. And for the record, Chris Smith, I was going to suggest that just before you were to address some further comments, that if the commission were to see fit to approve this, you could certainly have an explicit condition that all of the engineer's comments be incorporated into the approved plans.
Okay.
But thank you.
My second question is to that, the town engineer. I'm hearing he signed off on it and he didn't sign off on it. Is he done with this? Has he approved everything? And looking at this, it doesn't say it.
I can address it. Our staff report, unfortunately, is still a work in progress just because we're trying to get all those conditions together. And we were waiting on their revisions that they gave you tonight. The engineering comments have been addressed. Mr. Vaca and John Cabibbo have been in constant discussion about the revisions and recommendations made by the assistant town engineer. And those have been addressed. All he has to do is click complete on his step. And that part of the process is complete.
But the answer is he hasn't specifically addressed, but he hasn't approved it yet.
Yes, but he's
still in flow.
Yeah, pretty much. But his major concerns have been completed. He just has to press the green button on his step. He was just a little bit busy today, so he didn't get that far.
Well, it's a very important meeting tonight, so we'll have to make sure the town engineer is happy with this.
We always make sure all of our departments complete their steps prior to you making a decision.
So the answer to my question is no, he has not approved it yet.
But his comments are satisfied.
Okay, so my third question is the state statutes that you talked about before that were approved this year? Is there
Public Act 2129?
Okay, that was approved this year, voted on?
Yeah, September.
And what was the effective date?
September 11th, 2020.
No, is that when it was signed, or what was the effective? Some things are...
That is the adopted effective date of this Public Act.
All right.
We incorporate all of this into our ART process now, and also includes EV charging stations for new construction.
So they didn't give it a farther out effective date for towns to catch up with their regs? They just said this is it?
Not with this one.
So the
sometimes they give a window.
So actually the town had the option to opt out of that requirement. We did not.
Okay.
So, but we did opt out of the accessory dwelling units. Right. Should you remember that?
I do remember that.
Right. Yep. So that's the same part of the same Public Act.
Yep.
And that's my three questions.
So based on that, I'm looking around again with a lot of information. The staff's not ready. There's no staff recommendations yet. The town engineer, we haven't seen everything yet. You've given us a great presentation tonight. We've heard from the public. I would like to recommend that we're not going to close this public hearing. We still have one more meeting. I know I'm not ready to vote on this tonight.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, I know Mr. Wood has something to say. Excuse me. Sorry about that. But we would have, we're very comfortable with the town engineer and certainly the commission, if you were to see fit to approve the application, just making the approval subject to meeting their conditions, their comments, which from what we understand, they've been satisfied. You just need a final sign off, but we would certainly comply with any of those minor items that are outstanding. Would have no objection to the hearing being closed this evening. I know that Mr. Wood does have some.
That kind of affects us a little bit, because then that kind of limits our ability to ask questions. And I think based on some information tonight and based on a staff's report back to us, we might have questions. Once we close a public hearing, then it's strictly among us. And I'll be honest with you, I want to be fair to everybody. I'm not quite comfortable with that yet. I don't think we're at a position yet to do that.
But Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry, and I don't mean to interrupt, but Georgie and I were having a little sidebar conversation here. And I just want to make sure we're all understanding what she said, okay? So the town engineer has comments on the OpenGov system 1 through 8 that he published on December 1st. So John's?
No. It's not in our packet, Matt.
Hold on, do that for me. So Frank, Mr. Vaca had comments on December 1st, 2023. John Cabibbo, comments previously were November 16. These are things that, I think it's just a timing thing. These are things that we typically would include as conditions of approval. But the distinction I wanted to make was the pressing the green button that Georgie mentioned. That's just a function in the system when the person who made the comments is finished with their comments, they close out by, you know, pressing on their name on this particular piece of software to get it done. So I don't want you to kind of misconstrue that the fact that John hasn't pressed the green button, that John has any particular issues with the application, but we can wrap this all up if you want to continue the hearing and we can bring it to closure that way. I just wanted to make the distinction between pressing the green button in the system.
I see what you're saying, though. Yeah, it's not that John was...
actual comments.
Yeah. Right. We just don't
have... The substance of the comments themselves.
His comments are satisfied. Right.
But we just don't have that in our packet. We haven't read it. Yes. So I think where we are is because we might have questions on that, which we can't really answer once we close this public hearing. That's why we want to keep the public hearing open, just to continue for one more meeting. We might not have that. We might come here the next meeting, my recommendation. We might be satisfied what's in our pack, and we might automatically have you come up and boom, close the public hearing, discuss among ourselves, and vote. I just don't think we're comfortable enough to close a public hearing. I'm looking around. I'm not. So I'd like to propose that we keep the public hearing open tonight. We table this for the next meeting. And of course, I believe by date we have to act on it the next meeting. I'll be honest with you, as chairman, I would recommend that we highly do, because I don't believe it's fair for us to move this to the new Planning and Zoning Commission that's going to be seating here in January. So, to be quite frank with you, my goal as chairman and my advice to everyone is that this group decide on this next meeting. So I'm not trying to sandbag. To be quite frank, I'm not trying to sandbag. But I just think we're not positioned yet tonight to vote on this. So I would like to recommend, I know you wanted to say something here to wrap up tonight.
Yes.
Yep, please.
No, I was just going to say we've heard the concerns and the requests, and I think you're within the statutory 35 days anyways, but we're more this is a partnership. You are part of the town.
Yep.
You're delegated to by the town municipality to interpret and apply your regulations. We're here under your regulations, so we have no issue with that, and look forward to returning on the 21st, I believe it is.
Yep.
And that would be at 7 o'clock, just for the public notice.
Yep. After
legal requirement.
Yep. Absolutely. Thank you,
Mr. Wood. And I know you would have done that anyways, Mr. Chair. But Mr. Wood does have some closing comments, I think.
Yes. Please. Thanks. I want to emphasize that same point. This is truly a public-private partnership between the town, other state agencies, and the developer who is applicant here. This developer is, as you have heard from the president, Jessica Mullins herself, a very high quality, world-class developer with a global footprint that Enfield has gained the attention of. An interest in, and this is a terrific opportunity for the town, if I can opine myself. We have attempted throughout this process to be responsive to each of the entities and agencies that we've been involved with. We, in the process of the pre-development process for the project, we looked at various versions of how to develop this site and this property. And at its peak, in terms of density, we proposed 3 buildings with 123 units. Because there was concerns raised about both density and parking and the implications on the neighborhood, the developers stepped back that third building facing Pleasant Street and reduced the density and parking requirements by more than 40%. That was in response to comments from the public that the town received. In proposing that third building, the developer went to extensive means to obtain purchase and sale agreements with 3 adjacent property owners. One was the Doucettes, whose driveway was just in question. And I guess I didn't clarify, this is Peter Wood, the development consultant, for the record. And the developer also arrived at a purchase and sale agreement with the Fosses for the 2 other properties that face Pleasant Street that are in question here tonight, and for whom you've heard a lot of public comments. There was, you know, an opportunity for those properties to be sold, and they would have been removed and made part of this overall development parcel, and an additional building would have been built there. When we got all of the pushback on putting that building there, the developer chose to be responsive, and it had already gone through the whole process with the State Historic Preservation Office to meet their design guidelines and all of their other requirements to approve that building because it was in the historic district. We set all of that work aside and said, okay, we want to be a good neighbor. And so we stepped back from doing that additional property. In the process, we canceled those 2 purchase and sale agreements, which was going to be a lot of money out of the developer's pocket, which it was willing to do to enhance the development as it saw it. In response to public comments, though, we did not do that. And what you're hearing now, and I just wanted to be clear for the record, a lot of the opposition you're hearing is from two aggrieved neighbors who are not going to receive the payday that they had once thought they might have for the sale of those two buildings. There is a clear conflict at work here in terms of self-interest, and I just want that to be clear because that has colored a lot of the comments at public hearings both Monday night and tonight, and in previous public meetings. There's a lot of misinformation that was shared as a result. Most of that was responded to by our experts here on the team. There were a couple of other things, though, that I thought were important to point out. There is no vinyl siding on the proposed development. I'm not even sure that would meet the design requirements for a CHFA, but we are providing brick on the ground floor to be consistent with the neighborhood, and cementitious siding above, which is very high quality and not inexpensive material. This development of Union Square is proposed is a $33 million projected development in the heart of Thompsonville. It will create approximately 200 jobs to build this out. This is a tremendous economic opportunity and boost for Thompsonville. And while we've heard the concerns and the desires for more retail space and a true mixed-use development, now we meet the requirements because we do provide commercial office space. So we've met all of the requirements of zoning. And the developer seriously considered, as the town saw with the initial presentation, providing some kind of ground floor retail on the property. Investigating all of this further, as we presented in the last and first zoning commission hearing, we discovered a tremendous amount, over 50% vacancy rates in commercial properties in this immediate area. And, you know, if we could wave a magic wand and say, okay, we're going to make it happen, the developer would do so. If it had to make an investment to do so, it would do so. But economically, we cannot put together a development that is not financially viable. And that would be the case if we could not guarantee the lease up and the consistent ongoing use of that commercial area. There will be investors in for 15 years just from the initial investment in the tax credits on this development. These developments are typically rehabilitated. They have, you know, moderate to extensive rehabilitations 20 to 25 years after they're built, where roofs are replaced, parking lots, if they need repairs, are done, kitchens and bathrooms are upgraded or replaced. This is an ongoing investment in Thompsonville that will be very high quality housing. And indeed, it will be a competition to neighbors who can't meet these same standards for these rents. So this is a tremendous opportunity for this town, and I just wanted to underscore that.
Thank you. Thank you. So at this point, I'm going to entertain a motion to table and keep the public hearing open. I think it's been a long night. We've probably all said enough. So, yep.
Table and continue public hearing 3078.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Holinsky. Motion made by Vice Chairman DeGray, seconded by Commissioner Kalinsky, keep the public hearing open and continue this to the next meeting on December 21st at 7 p.m. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The record show is unanimous to table and continue this to the 21st.
And on behalf of the team and Ms. Mellons from
yeah,
thank you for your time.
No, thank you.
And, look forward to hopefully closing
everything
up.
We will.
You on the 21st.
And thank you for, you probably aren't coming back, but thank you for coming tonight. Hey, Joe,
like 5 minutes.
Would you give that to Lori? If you don't mind, I don't have to get up.
Thanks. Please. 5 minute recess.
Oh, I'd like to entertain a motion for a 5 minute recess. Motion made by Commissioner DeGray. Is there a second?
Second
by Vice Chairman Higley. All those in favor?
Aye.
Alex, we're just going to take a quick 5 minute recess, please. I call this meeting in Enfield Planning and Zoning Commission back to order. Item PH3080MA, there's been a request from the applicant that could not come tonight, that they've asked for it to be tabled. I'll entertain a motion to table PH3080MA, please.
So moved.
Motion made by Vice Chairman Higley, seconded by Vice Chairman DeGray to table PH3080MA till December 21st at 7 p.m. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Let the record show that it was 6-0 that to table this item. I'll read it. John's indisposed for a second. Public hearing XSU 23-01-04 Moody Road special permit application for the redevelopment expansion of the town fueling station. Applicant owner Town of Enfield, map 75, lot 103, I-1 zone. Is the applicant or the representative here?
Excuse me, Mr. Chair. Just real quick for the record,
yes.
It's XSU 23-01. The 40 is part of the address.
Okay, sorry. Thank you.
No problem. Just fixing that.
Thank you very much.
John Hammer from SLR Consulting. And yes, I was trying to go old school, as Donald would say. So I'm just going to set up the old school easel, so, and I'll be right back. But yes, the owner's rep is here.
Okay.
And I am here with Rock Edmond, who's our civil engineer.
That's okay.
This is all true. Landscape architects and our hand sketches, papers.
But while you're setting up, I would like to make a statement, if you don't mind, if I can. First of all, I want to recognize Georgiana Driver, our Aquifer Protection Agent, for the wonderful job she did in this application. I think everyone had it here describing the aquifer protection and the aquifer reasons and reasons why it's not prevalent for this hearing. Very well detailed. So I just want to again thank you, Georgie, for doing all that. That answers a lot of questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was a lot of conversation time of Kim Zappala from DEEP, and we went over comments with their original site plan, and the consultant in DPW was happy enough to include those. And as long as they follow best management practices, they're all right. So you received my letter, and I have it in writing from Kim Zappala that this is allowed.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Much appreciated.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Again, for the record, John Hammer, landscape architect from SLR Consulting. We've been in the town since the early 2000s. I've been working in Enfield since the Hazardville Streetscape project with the concrete unit pavers down Route 190. It was one of my first projects at what used to be Malona McBroom. So I've been around the block. I don't live in Enfield, but I have been doing a lot of work here. We've been working on the Higgins parking lot project, the Powder Hollow project, lots of streets in town, through our transportation department, and Enfield High School. We did the site work there. So we've been around, and I've been here. I was here, I think, last year in front of you. So it's good to be back. Yes, I am still old school John Hammer with the paper plans, and you'll probably have a hard time stopping me from doing that, but I have the full plan set here so we can have the TVs. It's ironic, I was in IT and I like paper, but I digress. So we're here tonight to discuss the addition to the fueling station at the DPW facility. Thank you for clarifying the aquifer protection. Appreciate that. We have the rendering up in front of you here. It's not an extremely complex project, but what we're proposing to do is provide fueling for the town facilities. There's two banks of fueling stations there. We're obviously going to be taking access off of Lego Way with ample curb cut radius. The town's reviewed all of that already. We clearly have run significant vehicle turn-in radius movements around this for John Cabibo to look at. The water, I'll get to the drainage in a minute. We've considered abutter properties and provided some screening. I have reviewed the comments from town regarding the species of the white spruces. I picked the white spruces because they grow slow compared to the white pines. I'm not a big fan of the white pines because they can be swords, and I cut 16 of them down at my property sidebar. But we can work with the town. Obviously, it's a town property, so we'll work with the town on if maybe arborvitaes might be something that can help in the short term, near term on that.
So you have seen condition number 10?
I saw that comment come in on that, which I appreciate. It's always good when it's a town property for the town to give feedback on their own, their own stuff. So thank you. So, well, we can work on that and get the species sorted out. But the gist of screening the properties is there, and that's why we've zigzagged, staggered the plants, changed species and things. So that's been taken into consideration. There's an additional parking lot that's shown on the plans here with a sidewalk. Oh, there's a cursor. So there is a sidewalk. Come on. Yes, what luck. So we can take the all of the people who would be parking this parking lot. We've provided a safe and accessible route, which would be nice, so you don't have to cut across the grass, obviously, not to be obvious, but there's a crosswalk that we're providing down here and a connection down to an existing striped area here. So now we'll have safe access from the new parking lot. We're going to be providing access from the facility, the existing facility, up to the fuel pumps, which just the way that the operations work, they're going to have people that need to go up and down there. So we're addressing that for them. Whoa, look at that. Too far. Super clicky. Apologies for that. I kind of worked out of order here, but we'll jump back to the entry. We're providing drop ramps for the existing walk that's out there, because with our curb cut, we're going to need to provide the ramps there. So those will be ADA compliant. That's a standard thing. With a crosswalk across it, at the gateway, there is going to be a controlled access gate here, a motorized gate. It's currently being proposed as a single slide gate. We're not exactly sure if it'll be one or two, but the gist of it is there will be an access control gate there for the fuel pumps. The entire facility will be fenced in because there's an existing fence along here already. So we're looking to loop the fence around the top, behind the landscaping, around the back, and down to this area over here. There is some earthwork that we're doing, obviously, to make this work. I was actually out there tonight with my truck with lights with Donald, digging some holes to check topsoil depth, which is pretty funny, but us paper people can still dig holes. Anyway, there's about 12 inches, 10 to 12 inches of topsoil out there, if you were interested in knowing that. We will be reusing that topsoil where it can be used on site. There's cut and fill operations that are happening out here. The gist of the water and the overland flow is that these darker green areas are stormwater basins. So there's one here. They also perform stormwater quality, which I won't steal Rock's thunder on, but I'm just gonna breeze over that. We're essentially taking all the water off of the surface and putting it into these basins. We're also providing, even though we're not required to, oil-water separators, so that if there's a fuel spill, we have this first opportunity to catch it into the structures. I am stealing a little bit of your thunder. But otherwise, I think it's probably a good chance to turn it over to Rock, but we could field questions on the site plan itself. I went through it pretty quickly. If anybody has any questions, Commissioner, you're welcome to.
I think we've seen some of this, and honestly, refresh everyone's memory, when the 824 came in front of us for approval for this project, I think most of this, not all of it, but most of this was already presented to us at the time.
Okay.
So this is like the second time around for some of this for us, which is no problem. Thank you.
I don't know if I should apologize or not.
Not at all.
I'm moving quickly.
Yeah, so, that's fine.
The parking lot's probably different. The sidewalks are probably different than they were before. And otherwise, I think that the layout is similar to what you saw before. The biggest changes are probably on the drainage, so I'm going to, and the utilities, I'm going to hand that off to Rock.
Beautiful. I get the fun part, unfortunately for me. Just for the record, Rock M, an associate civil engineer with SLR International Corporation. So John had touched on kind of what the gist is going on with the stormwater itself. So Just a sticking point that I would just want to make. So currently the existing conditions today, this is completely just grass. This is just an open field. So we're going to be bringing in 1.25 acres of impervious into this area. So best management practice is to mitigate that flow. So change in the impervious surface changes the amount of peak flow that's occurring. So as part of best management practices, we kind of have to contain that, and we have to idealize and lock in that flow. So what we're doing is we're providing three essential retention basins that are located here. And John can attest to, based upon his digging, this specifically is pretty sandy soils. So one of the reasons why we're very comfortable with doing retention storage here is because it's very sandy soils. So digging those basins, you're getting into that parent material. So you can kind of see where right over here, you're getting into a small depression here, a small depression here, but then a large depression here. These three areas essentially are open surfaces for you to percolate through into the ground. So you're getting straight into the sandy material. One thing that just based upon our previous experience with building developments and going through this is 9 times out of 10, they come back with topsoil on the top, and then you kind of lose some of that special, wonderful quality. So what we do is we integrate a what we call a stone wick in through these basins. So it's essentially just a gravel strip that's dug into the soil. You know, it's maybe about 3 feet deep. It allows it to kind of percolate into the surrounding soils. Very nice, very quick, very simple, very wonderful. Also cheap and effective. One thing John did not touch on, so I do get to get a little bit of thunder. So what's going on here is all this flow is going into these basins. These essentially overflow through a series of flared end sections and then go through a hydrodynamic separator first and then to the oil-water separator. So it's doing kind of double duty, mostly because we do have a fueling station here. We want to be very cognizant of the ramifications if there was a spill. So we're kind of doing a kind of a treatment train of sorts. In tangential with this, we are also providing some catch basins. These catch basins have 4-foot deep sumps as well as siphon hoods on the outlets, kind of to hold and trap some of those materials just in case. So it does have some floatable removal qualities there, as well as because we're going to be infiltrating into the ground, we want to make sure that any sort of debris and any sort of oils are kind of held back from getting into those specific areas. But essentially, we're making everything through overland flow go directed to these areas. There is an outlet that's located here. It is strictly emergency only. So the way that we actually design everything is we're trying to reduce the amount of peak flow by keeping everything status quo. So this particular large basin actually has no flow coming out of it. So what we kind of anticipate is, well, what happens if there is actually flow coming out of it? So we develop worst case scenario, we'll over design it. We'll put a emergency overflow structure, which is essentially just the same thing that we're using, which is a flared end section on a pipe, gets shipped out, and then it goes to a level spreader, a plunge pool right at the end. They should theoretically never see any flow, but you never know, especially with the changing times these days. Rain events are getting more and more interesting. But essentially, that's the drainage in a nutshell. Because there's no, there's no public water, no public sewer required for any of this. That's kind of the extent of the utilities besides the lighting. So we're also providing lighting throughout. So these are all going to be full cutoff, dark sky compliant fixtures. And we're very far away from any neighboring parcels. So we're obviously not going to have any light spillage from this. Oh, there's also going to be the, obviously there's the fuel tanks there themselves. This is going to be housed with a above head canopy. The above head canopy also has downspouts on it that'll go into the surrounding basins, but essentially those will also have individual lights that are also illuminate the fuel station. Downlighting, correct. Just everything conforms to the 2004 Stormwater Quality Manual, as well as we provided a robust sediment erosion control manual. You know, these are sandy soils, so we want to be cognizant of making sure that everything's kind of staying in place. But there's no anticipation for any sort of sediments to go in off-site or anywhere. Also, just because I mentioned the word off-site, we want to just make the point that there is no peak flow runoffs that are going off-site that are any sort of increase. I think that kind of wraps everything for me in a nutshell.
Questions from commissioners? Commissioner Holinsky?
Yeah, could you elaborate on the roof a little bit?
Yes.
I think there was a little description in our narrative that said it was similar to a gas station roof.
Yes, correct.
That kind of thing.
So, it honestly, if you think about a gas station, it is essentially the exact same type of canopy.
Okay. Okay, and you'll have the fire protection nozzles in there and all that stuff?
It'll meet the building code.
That's correct.
So it's located right over the tanks?
Yes. Yeah. So I'll zoom in a little bit.
Yeah, okay.
So there's this dash line throughout here. Yeah, that's essentially the canopy up top.
Okay, great. All right, thank you.
No problem.
Yep, so let me get through a technical. Is there anyone in the public who would like to speak for or against this application? Is there anyone in the public who would like to speak for or against this application for a third time? Seeing none. Does staff have any comments that you want to add? I know, George, you kind of already did, but is it any more matters?
No, just real quick, just wanted to add that we handed out some materials to you. We gave you a hard copy of the staff's report. Yeah. We apologize for the version that we sent you digitally. We did include a copy of SLR's supplement relative to stormwater. That's pretty self-explanatory. John Kibibo is all set. I did speak with him. He's approved the plan. And then we got comments late today from Connecticut Water Company. So I did include in a handout to you a suggestion for four additional site-specific conditions to add to the motion. And those are directly from the Connecticut Water Company communication.
Can you direct us to that, Matt, a little more precise so we don't...
A one-pager.
Just for the record, Rock Emmond, SLR International Corporation, it specifically has a date on the top left corner that says 12-7-23 M. Davis.
Yeah, I have it, but I'm looking...
I have some extras here.
I'm just looking for where... You wanted us to add some conditions, and I just wanted to...
Oh, it would be conditions 9 through 12 in the site specifics. So in the draft motion, it the site specifics end at number 8. Yeah, so we handed it out.
Oh, right, right.
It should be on the
table. Yeah. So it's this one here. That's why I'm asking.
That's
at the end of the new
handout. So now it would be 22 conditions.
Yeah. Mr. Chair?
So now it'll be 22 conditions. Yeah.
Mr. Chair?
9 through 12 are new.
It's the last page.
You see it, John?
There it is.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yep.
Understand that most of those are actually already addressed in the documents and the regulations that apply to these kinds of uses. It's just kind of gilding the lily a little bit. I don't know if Georgie has something she wants to add.
I do.
She does.
They're also included under their aquifer registration renewal process as well. Those are some of the things they have to abide by anyways when they come in for their registration and permit requests. One being best management practices, which is recommended by Kim Zappla from DEEP and Jessica Baldwin of the Connecticut Water Company. So those are also some of the site specifics that you see, which also kind of correspond to their aquifer requirements as well anyways.
Obviously, the project is going to be a major improvement, frankly. The removal of the existing underground tanks in and of itself is a major improvement. These tanks are above ground, much easier to kind of control and manage and monitor than underground systems. And it's been reviewed by DEP. It complies with the aquifer requirements.
So basically, and now we would have 26 conditions.
Right, you would add four, whatever the number was. And that's it.
Mr. Chair, I have a question. Yep. Two questions. One is,
I didn't see in the site plans we reviewed, we received about, we saw existing conditions, we saw new conditions, but I didn't see explicitly referring to the landscaping that's being removed. So if you can clarify exactly what's remaining versus being removed, and then I have a...
I think it's just grass. It's just grass?
The areas I'm talking about, there's three trees at the entrance of the new parking lot, and then it looks like the exit of the drive on the far west side as well. Right.
So we would expect John Hammer from SLR. We would expect this tree to stay, and down here is. There are quote unquote trees in there, but there's also a wall, Jersey barrier wall along here, and the first tree would go.
Mm-hmm.
So those will all be removed out of concerns of safety.
Understand. So in the parking area, you expect two of the three to remain?
Yeah, I would expect this one to stay here. Mm-hmm. And the one on the corner to stay. The pink ones are not shade trees. So.
Right. Yep. Yeah, and I do see you are supplementing as well. Appreciate that clarification. The second part was with regards to parking. Maybe I brought it up in the referral, but the narrative doesn't explain it. It's a pretty considerable addition of parking. I don't see it. The fueling station demanding that much parking. So can you just provide some narrative as to what was the need?
Yeah, our understanding is that the DPW facility has a tremendous shortage of parking for visitors, which I can attest to, and you probably can attest to if you've been there.
Okay.
So this, we actually had an additional drive that looped this down and around, but there's such a concern for a lack of parking there that we removed the second drive to add the additional three or four spaces back in.
Okay.
So the reason for the parking is because of a shortage.
For the other facility?
Yes.
So it's not for the fueling station?
No, it's not directly associated with the fuel station, but with all the site work going on there, the logical thing to, you know, is just a sensible thing to do that. As part of the application.
Understand. Gotcha. Yeah, again, I just wanted to clarify because it wasn't in the narrative.
No problem.
That makes sense.
My
understanding, Chris, is that predominantly that new parking lot is going to be used for visitors, predominantly, which will free up a lot of, if you can move the thing up a little bit, it'll free up a lot of spaces for employees in that other area that's now shared with visitors.
Makes sense.
I think that the handicapped parking spaces might remain for visitors, but. That's the goal there.
That makes sense. Okay, great. I appreciate that.
Yep, no problem.
Any other questions? I'll entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Motion made by Vice Chairman DeGray. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Vice Chairman Higley to close the public hearing. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 And I'll entertain a motion to approve.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion to approve XSU 23-01 application for special permit approval for Town Fleet Fueling Facility at 40 Moody Road, Town of Enfield owners, applicant, SLR agent, map 75, lot 27, I-1 zone per the reference plans, reports, application materials listed herein with the following 26 conditions to include four conditions requested by the Connecticut Water Company as dated in a memo from Matt Davis dated 12/7/23. They would be site-specific conditions numbered 9 through 12 to be added. You want me to read?
No, I think we can waive the reading of that. I think everybody has that and Matt has that, so
okay.
Incorporate that. There's a motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Hlinski. Motion made by Secretary Petronella, seconded by Commissioner Hlinski for the 26 site-specific, 26 conditions, spelling out the four new site-specific ones. There's been a second. Secretary, call the roll when ready.
Yep. Lou Fiore.
Four.
Virginia Higley.
Four.
Linda DeGray.
Four.
Francis Alimo.
Four.
Joseph Muley.
Four.
Kenneth Alinsky.
Four.
And John Petronella's four.
The record shows unanimous approval. Good luck, gentlemen. Thank you very much. Good seeing you.
Congratulations to the town.
Yeah, yeah. This was a project that's been in the works or talked about for a long time.
Always a pleasure coming.
I think they started. All right, I know.
All right.
Well, for the record, I think they started talking about this project back when I was on the council in 2000, 2005. So that's how long I've been talking about this.
I'm happy to be on this end.
Yeah.
3 years after,
hasn't it? Yeah, yes, absolutely. All right, moving on to the next one. PH 3082, 1559 King Street.
Can I do this one now?
Yes, you can.
The Enfield Planning and Zoning Commission will hold a public hearing at their regular meeting on Thursday, December 7th, 2023 at 7 p.m. in the Town Hall Council Chambers at 820 Enfield Street, Enfield, Connecticut, concerning the following. Public hearing number 3082, 1559 King Street. Special permit application for an accessory outdoor storage area. Baker Properties Limited Partnership. Applicant owner, MAP 1739 SDD Zone.
Hi, the applicant. Yeah, please.
Oliver Goldstein.
I mean, you could pull a little closer, I think. Yeah.
Oliver Goldstein, 4 West Red Oak Lane, White Plains, New York.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Long
good
drive.
Evening. Good evening.
Yeah, thank long you. Drive.
And long drive home.
Yes, yes.
So I'm here just to talk about a outdoor storage space that we'd like to provide for an incoming tenant who is basically has signed an 80,000 square foot lease with us as part of the offering that we had for them was the ability to hopefully provide outdoor storage for them at our building, which again is on I-91 and King Street. The site has previously had some outdoor storage in this vicinity. It's about 6,720 square feet of outdoor storage. It would be an 8-foot vinyl fence. They would understand that they couldn't store above the 8-foot fence. It is going to be air conditioning equipment. I don't have too much else to say.
Thank you. Very quickly, I take it you must be familiar with the site-specific conditions that we have on here. One is no materials stored will be inert, no waste materials, no junk debris,
yep.
Bulky or solid waste, no additional lighting will be permitted. And all materials shall be stored within the confines of the fencing. I mean, you're fully aware of all
that. The only thing with the lighting, as I understood, is if there was a safety requirement from the town, then we would have to lighting.
Yes. Yeah. I just didn't read the whole thing. Yes. Okay. Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. So you're familiar with all that.
Yes.
Okay. Any questions from the commission? You sit. Seeing none. Is there anyone in the public who'd like to speak for or against this application? Is there anyone in the public who'd like to speak for or against this application? For a third time, seeing none, public participation as public hearing is closed. Does staff have anything they want to add to this?
WPCA is all set and the fire marshal is all set.
Okay, great. There was a comment here, Matt, if I can. Prior required plantings, SPR 67 will be installed as if needed. The owners have replaced some evergreens already. And we're pretty comfortable with what's going on?
Yeah, I went out there a couple of times and tried to I didn't get to the point where I'm counting bushes, kind of a thing. So, we've agreed that I think we'll work together if there are some plantings that do need to be. Some have already been replaced. They're a little smaller than we would typically do, but that's something we can take care of, kind of during the construction phase, if need be.
Okay, great.
Because we basically have the older site plan that was the basis for the development itself, and a prior commission had required a number of plantings in the islands and then down kind of on the I-91 side as well. So I just wanted to make sure that those are still there and still healthy. So that's
right. So your thumbs up.
Yep.
Any questions for the applicant? Nothing all set. Seeing none, I will entertain a motion to close this public hearing.
So moved.
Motion made by Vice Chairman Higley, seconded by Vice Chairman DeGray to close this public hearing. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Let the record show it was unanimous to close the public hearing. Entertain a motion to approve.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion to approve public hearing number 3082 with conditions and modifications, application for special permit approval to allow 6,720 square foot accessory and subordinate outdoor storage area at 1559 Enfield Street, Baker Properties Limited Partnership owners, applicant Paul Vitaliano, PE of VHB agent, map 17, lot 39, SDD zone, per the reference plans, reports, and application materials listed herein, and the following 29 conditions.
Thank you. Is there a second? Motion made by Secretary Petronella, seconded by Commissioner Muley? Any, we all set? We okay? Okay.
Sorry, I just heard him say Enfield Street.
It is King Street. For the record, it is King Street.
It does say Enfield Street.
Yeah,
you're right.
The motion does say, so let's strike back that second. John, you're going to have to reread it, I'm afraid.
Sure. Okay. I'd like to make a motion to approve public hearing number 3082 with conditions and modifications, application for special permit approval to allow 6,720 square foot accessory and subordinate outdoor storage area at 1559 King Street, Baker Properties Limited Partnership, owners applicant Paul Vitaliano, PE of VHB agent, map 17, lot 39, SDD zone, per the reference plans, reports, and application materials listed herein, and the following 29 conditions.
Thank you. And thank you for doing that again, John.
No problem.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Muley. Any discussion? Seeing none, whenever you're ready, Secretary.
Lou Fiore.
Four.
Virginia Higley.
Four.
Linda DeGray.
Four.
Francis Alimo.
Four.
Joseph Muley.
Four.
Kenneth Alinsky.
Four.
And John Petronella's four.
Let the record show is unanimous, 7-0 to approve this application. Good luck, and sorry you had to wait so long. Have a safe ride home. I know you have a long one. Okay. Moving on to old business, site plan review. Reopen off the table. All those in favor of removing SPR 1923 off the table? First, somebody entertain a motion. I'm getting tired. Oh. Motion made by Commissioner Vice Chairman Higley.
Second.
By Vice Chairman DeGray to remove SPR 1923 off the table. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
The show is unanimous to remove SPR 1923 off the table. Old business site plan review. And I don't think you have to read it again, John. It's for 157 South Road. Good evening.
Oh.
Yeah, you don't have to read it again, John. We took it off the table. Some of ours, too.
Every Thursday's like this?
Yes.
Every other?
But almost like every other. Yeah, it's not every Thursday. Yeah. Every other. Go ahead, please.
Oh, for the record, Russell Heinz with me is the applicant, Eric Hewitt.
Thank you.
We were trying to get it closed last meeting, and you received that plan not in time you wanted to review it. And basically, I thought we went through everything we needed. And I don't know if you had any questions or were here to answer them. If not,
thank you.
We'd like to go home.
Yeah, could just maybe, I know it's getting late, maybe 2 minutes just to review for the schematic? Not very long, just, yeah.
No, what we're proposing, obviously, is three storage units.
Yeah, he's right, we can hear him.
Town fire marshal asked us to show turning radiuses, 50-foot. So in doing that, I had to shorten up a couple of the buildings, but he has since approved the layout that we have now.
Okay.
I think we had the town engineer, he had a couple of comments that we said we'd be willing to take care of. Other than that, we really, I don't think there was anything else that we had to deal with other than, you know, it's really the only thing on here is going to be electricity for the units, lighting. Other than that, there's no sewer, there's no water, nothing like that. The town building inspector for the building department said we were required to have soil facilities. They come with an agreement to do the soil testing and everything. We're going to use, if they have to, at some point in time, need a toilet, they use the body shop, which is Eric's facilities.
Thank you. Staff have any comments?
All we did was we took the memo that you had 2 weeks ago, and on the second page under the staff comments, under the engineering section specifically, we inserted John's comments, and then we included those, or at least a reference to those, I think, in the draft motion or in the motion.
Okay.
Yeah, we did. It's site-specific number 17 is John's stuff.
Okay.
So.
And there's not as 33 conditions.
Yes.
Yeah.
Correct, 33.
Questions? Yep. Commissioner DeGray?
Through the chair to staff, I did not see any maintenance of the parking area, sweeping and that on plans. And maybe that I missed it. So, I don't know. Am I just missing it?
I think he would have to comply with the BMPs that would typically be expected for the maintenance of paved parking area. So sweeping, catch basin cleaning once or twice a year, these kinds of things. So those, I think, are kind of standard requirements.
Weren't anywhere on the plans. We normally have them on the plans.
So if you want to add a 34, we could absolutely.
That would be a good thing.
Yep.
Just to ensure that. Now, he sells it, somebody comes along.
Sure, sure, absolutely. Yeah.
So you work on that way. We'll ask more questions, and I'll get back
okay.
to you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Well, I have a question. And I don't mean to be a Debbie Downer here, but I have a concern, I guess, a real concern. So I'm just going to play a scenario for you, okay, so see if you follow along. It's make-believe, but just see if you follow along. I know that basically this storage facility is going to be no man on. They're going to have key cards that they're going to get from you. And if there's a problem, they can call you on phone. So there's no active employee there at this facility. So let's make believe I'm an antique dealer. It's Sunday afternoon at the end of my show, wherever I am. I have a truck. I come in. I'm going to unload into the storage area. It's 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I've been at the show all day, and I'm working. And gosh darn it. I got to go to the bathroom real bad. Now, what am I going to do at 3 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon? Am I going to have to lock up the gates and run down to a body shop to go to the bathroom? And what happens if I doubt very much the body shop's going to be open at 3 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon. So where do I go to the bathroom?
How do you want me to answer that?
The answer, I guess, is there is nowhere for me to go to the bathroom.
Go to McDonald's.
No. I'm not going to make it to McDonald's.
Okay.
No, it works. I think that the whole bathroom thing works when the body shop's open. And I think that's really, that's nice of you. That works. But it doesn't work when the body shop is closed and after hours. It's like, so why am I going to approve an application, even if it meets the requirements, if it doesn't fulfill a basic requirement of having a bathroom for the people who are renting that space for you? It's like, why am I doing this? This is ridiculous to me. I'm being quite honest with you. Even though you meet the requirements from a zoning standpoint, at this point, I don't care. It doesn't have a bathroom. It has a bathroom when a body shop is open. And I commend you for making that arrangement. But it doesn't have a bathroom when it's off hours. Unless are you limiting off hours? Can people come in there at 10 o'clock at night or on Sundays?
Well, we're going to have limited hours.
Limited hours. So
I mean, I can't come through this building here at 3 o'clock.
But people have a key card. It's not going to work on Sunday afternoon. So if I rented a space from you and I get a key card from you, I'm not going to be able to go in on a Sunday afternoon to my storage area.
I don't know.
It's okay. At least that's honest. No, that's honest. I appreciate the honesty. I'm not trying to bait you. I'm asking honest questions. I'm not trying to bait you. Believe me. So I guess that's just one.
I think if you were coming from an antique show and you got off the highway, you might want a coffee or something like that, and you stopped at McDonald's, you could have used the facility there,
okay.
Knowing that it's a Sunday at 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to debate it, but that's all right. I just want to give you my thought on that. And I think the plans are fine. I just don't like the idea of renting a store that doesn't have a bathroom. I'm not sure. I don't think our regulations allow for him to have porta potties on a permanent level. No, he could on a temporary.
That would be Department of Health.
Yeah. So, okay. I just wanted to get my thought out there. But I wasn't trying to beat you. I just wanted to make the point. Any other questions? Just wanted to make my point what that bothers me.
Mr. Chair?
Yep.
Yeah. For your comment, you know, the building department has responded to, and it does say, the bathroom is required and will be provided in the auto repair shop. So, well, I understand that, but I get the same concern, and I was thinking about the same thing. Mm-hmm. The body shop's probably open 40 hours, Monday through Friday, maybe Saturday half a day, but the access to the storage facility is 24/7. Am I assuming that correct or something? Probably.
They were going to be the same hours as the body shop.
But how do you keep people up?
Yeah, I guess if they have access or a key card to get in a gate or whatever, they would have 24/7 access, I would assume.
I think that could be done by electronically, you shut it off, you can't come. Your hours of the gate being open is going to be Monday through Friday from 3 to whatever times the body shop's open. I'm sure that gate can be kept closed at those times when it's not open.
Then you would need a condition of approval for hours, right?
That's fine.
I don't think we can do that. We can't. I don't think we can do hours.
And we can do a condition of approval hours if the applicant agrees to it. But then how do we monitor that? And how do we monitor?
We've ever did that before.
Yeah.
We can't.
I'm looking. Does staff want to add a comment here, give us some guidance, or rather not?
I kind of, yeah.
I have a bladder, too, so I can appreciate all your comments.
Yeah.
You know, that's an impolitic thing to say, but I'm certainly not going to be here to check the gate and the hours. And
I know.
As a practical matter, people will use it on Sunday. It's when people move.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's
a practical matter. That's when people are going to be there. There's a building code, right? There's a health code. And the building code said it could be within 500 feet. It is within 500 feet. The building code doesn't talk about, to my knowledge, doesn't talk about hours of operation.
Right.
But it says, you know, shall be available.
Right.
You could, that kind of implies hours of operation, you know, that it will be available, kind of a thing. So I don't have a good solution for you. I mean,
if you guys want,
We don't know if we can. I hear you're gonna, I know you're gonna offer. I know what you, I don't know if we don't know if we can do that. That's why we're asking. Joe, excuse me. Commissioner Mueller, go ahead.
Thank you, sir. For comparison, I rent a unit up the street from there at on South Road.
South Road.
And they have a person there all the time, but their hours, they close at 10 o'clock and the office is only open till 6. And that's when the bathroom's available, only when the office is open. So I don't know how that works.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
So they have a bathroom there, but it's only available when the office is open from eight till six.
You can't get in if you went to 10.
If I went there after 10 o'clock, the gate won't open.
The gate will not open.
Yeah, they have the posted hours at the gate. And,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So thank you.
Okay. Thank you for that.
George. I can actually comment to that. Me being as old as I am, I moved around a lot, grad school and undergrad throughout Mass and Connecticut. I pretty much lived out of storage units for a couple years of my life. Every single storage unit that I've rented has had limited access at night, and all bathrooms have always been in the offices. This is typical amongst storage units that I've rented, especially along the East Coast, and now it's kind of expanding into Mass. You'll see that in West Haven, New Haven, Ellington even. You'll also see that in Salem and Beverly and Gloucester. That's just typical because when you're doing self-storage moving, you're in there not for long. You're usually in and out. I mean, like, a lot of people don't want to stay and play in storage units. They typically do what they need to do and then leave. And you have to use the bathroom. You kind of plan ahead of time for that. So most storage units that you see today just have their bathrooms in the offices and it's limited access. So that's just typical of that type of industry.
Okay. So it sounds like you would be limited to, you would be not limited. It sounds like you would be agreeable for us, even though non-enforceable, to put some hours of operation around this a little bit because of the availability, not having a bathroom. you have, since you're the applicant and it's a site plan, we can't mandate that, but we're looking to you. Would you want to throw something on the table, see if it sticks?
I say, just like what he said, the office is open. When the office is open,
right,
you can use the bathroom, and then the gates are closed at 10 o'clock at night or whatever, and, you know. So there's an hour of operation. You don't want them there at 2 in the morning.
Why should somebody be there at 2 o'clock in the morning?
You don't want them there at 2 in the morning.
Well, yeah, but usually, like on a Sunday. Mm-hmm. I know he used Sunday, but when you rented your storage units on the weekends, was somebody in the office?
Sundays, no.
But Saturdays?
You have access to your storage unit, but there's no office open on Sunday.
How about Saturdays?
Saturday till noon.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So it's not that there is limited hours. So, what do you guys think?
With what I'm hearing and the experience, I'm not familiar with self-storage units and so forth. But from what I'm hearing, it seems like that's typical and that's what they do. And you know what the hours are; they're established when you rent it. You know that you got a bathroom use at certain days and times, and after that, you're on your own. I guess that's the way it is.
So how's this? So you have to kind of have to, I'm going to propose it, but you have to propose it because it's a site plan.
Suggestion.
How about making sure that when you post your hours, we can make it a condition if you agree. When you post your hours, you also post some type of bathroom hours. I think you're getting what I'm getting at here.
Okay.
So I want to make that a condition.
A lot of times on Sunday, I'm down there.
You might be down there anyways.
I'm down and you have to go.
Yeah.
You'll be welcome.
Yeah, out of curiosity, do you have to go through your shop or is there,
no,
is there is
right,
like...
Right in, as soon as you go through the door.
Okay.
It's in the office.
So it sounds like we're going to add two conditions to this. If you're agreeable.
I'm agreeable.
Instead of saying bathroom hours,
No, I think it's office hours.
Office hours.
When your office is open,
better?
Office hours.
Yeah.
Bathroom's open.
Office hours.
Office hours.
Annual sweeping of the parking lot.
All right, so go ahead. Let's take a shot at it and make sure he agrees before we go. So, so go ahead. You had the 30,
so,
condition 30.
Annual sweeping of the parking lot to remove sand and debris. Yeah. And posted office hours. How's that? Posted office hours for 35. I like that one better.
Well, yeah, but there's no office.
Yeah, he said there's an office in the body shop.
Posted body shop hours.
Oh,
so the sign would say posted body shop hours.
All right, body shop. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Which would be the minimum hours.
Right.
You might be there more. Right. Right. So people know that's where to go. It would be posted when they go in there and they drive. They're going to know when they rent from you anyways. But,
yep.
But, okay. So that'd be two new conditions. All right. Is that?
Yep.
Sound?
And that's okay.
Perfect.
Okay.
That's fine.
And the applicant agrees?
Yeah, I agree.
Thank you. Any other questions? The secretary then make a motion to approve with two new conditions.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion to approve SPR number 1923 with conditions and modifications. Application for site plan approval to allow three self-storage buildings and associated parking, driveways, and ancillary improvements at 157 South Road, National Fleet Leasing LLC owner, Eric Hewitt, Hewitt applicant, Russ Hines agent, map 55, lot 82, I-1 zone per the reference plans, reports, and application materials listed herein with the following 35 conditions to include two other conditions. One would be annual sweeping of parking and roadways to remove sand and debris. And another condition added to the applicant to post the body shop hours for all rentals lessees, I guess.
Yeah, fine. It's fine. The motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Holinsky. Any discussion? Seeing none, whenever you're ready, Mr. Secretary.
Okay, Lou Fiore. Linda DeGray.
Four.
Virginia Higley.
Four.
Frank Alamo.
Four.
Joseph Muley.
Four.
Kenneth Holinsky.
Four.
And John Petronella is four.
Thank you. You've been approved. You're all set.
Thank you.
Thanks for the combination and working together. That's the way it's supposed to is. Thank you. Good luck with your project.
Can I just clarify who seconded that, please?
Pardon?
Who seconded that? Who made the second?
Commissioner Holinsky.
Okay, thank you.
No.
Hi.
Good luck.
Good holiday season.
Thank you very much.
No, 11 o'clock.
So what the pigeons loose.
No, it's 11.
No, 11.
11.
Where am I with this thing? Kenneth Holinsky.
Was it 10?
No, it's 11. You have to.
No, it's 11.
We can do it. Still do it.
Yeah, no, we're not.
Okay, all right, we're not.
We're almost done.
All right.
We're almost done.
We're almost done. Okay.
We're on the other side. We're almost done. Frank was sick.
Okay, you all guys all set? You all set? Moving on to other business. Again, discussion on extension of a special use permit. That's just a holding place for when Lori and Matt are ready to come forward for in front of us. Any correspondence? Any commissioner's correspondence? Commissioner Alamo?
I watched the meeting last week, or last 2 weeks ago, and I seen that you were going to resign. I'm sorry to see you go, and I even seconded your as chair, but I want to be honest with you. Some of the language and some of the words you used in your speech were a little offensive to me. I was on the other commission, and I'm going to be on a commission going forward. I just want to say, I mean, you used words like personal interest, honesty.
Yep.
You took, this is a non-political board.
Yep.
And you made it political.
Yep.
And, you know, I took offense to that.
Well, I'm sorry
and
you
I,
did.
But I, and it like tainted the last commission, and it's going to taint the next commission in some of them words. But those are your feelings, and I respect you for saying that.
Yep.
I just wanted to let you know, it was fun working with you, and I enjoyed working with you,
Frank.
And I respected you all, all the way through, but I just, some of the words that you used weren't appropriate.
No, that's fine.
But you're entitled to your feelings.
You're looking at 50 years of political experience in this town, third generation. I've been around the block a million times, more positions than you've ever held. So I know what goes on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's fine. No,
so I'll stick by my comments.
That I mean, and if you want to stick by them, I mean they're on the public record,
and I make sure everybody got them.
Right. No, and
every councilman too. Okay,
I'm just saying. That's okay, my feeling, and you have the right to your feeling.
That's okay. Let's move on to number 13. Planning staff report, please.
So,
oh, I'm sorry. planning staff
you
report.
Threw me for
yeah, don't
a second.
Go by the number.
All right. Just real quick. There's been questions as to why certain things don't get built or get building permits quickly after they're approved, and a lot of that has to do with the Office of the State Traffic Administration. It's called OSTA, and they have the right to review new applications regarding parking. Most recently, there's been the two cannabis shops at the mall, and they have taken keen interest in to make sure that there's adequate parking at the mall. We don't feel that there's much of an issue, but it's being held up by them. So that is one reason why things get held up. And the building department may not issue a permit unless OSTA has approved it.
Right.
So.
That's also going on at the old Enfield Getty Gas, too.
Yeah.
And also, I understand Artioli's possibly is also in the same thing with OSTA?
I think that's more DOT with encroachment into the right-of-way.
Right, yeah, the snow shelf, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So the state does get involved with the applications after you approve them.
Yeah.
So it's not always, you know, just because we approve, they get you know, carte blanche.
Yeah.
So, and then the other thing is the solar farms. This is part of the state siting council's jurisdiction. So if solar farms are over certain megawatts, it goes to the siting council. The local municipalities have no jurisdiction for permits. We do have the right to, state on the, we have the right to go and appeal not appeal it. I'm sorry. That's the wrong word. I'm tired too.
Opine our opinion, right?
So intervene. Thank you. So we have the right to intervene once the application has been posted with the siting council. And other people may also have rights from as far as abutters.
Yep.
So, but we have to wait until the actual application has been accepted. So, and that's just like the real quick on it.
And I think we've talked about that numerous times about solar farms here, trying to use this to educate but inform the residents of how that process all works. And they really need to be contacting our state representatives at this point.
Yeah. And if you're interested, I mean, anybody could Google Connecticut State Siting Council and there's a plethora of information as to what's regulated and how it's regulated and how you could become involved with the application.
Yep.
So.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah,
So at this last one that's going to happen or it's in the process on Town Farm.
Yep.
When they came before us, I asked them that. I said, do the neighbors know about this?
They do.
And they said, oh, yeah, they're like, they own the land. Everybody knows. And then apparently some letter went out to the neighbors after the fact. They said to me that people knew. And then a letter went out because I'm seeing now at the town council meeting some people were like blindsided.
I can't speak to the timing, but it is a requirement that they notify the abutters before they make application to the county, the state siting council.
Right. But I'm just saying, I asked them that night, and they said, oh, yeah, everybody knows. And then all of a sudden, nobody
knows. I can't speak to the timing.
Yeah. But at least, we...
It is a requirement.
Yeah, we asked them.
Yeah. Yeah, you did.
Yeah, we did.
Yes, absolutely.
We really do. We did ask them, and they said yes.
They don't even have to come in front of us. That's not even a requirement. That's really, they just want a courtesy to us.
But at least we asked.
Yeah, we did.
That's all we can really do.
Yeah, we did.
They said yes. I guess they didn't.
So.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay.
Anything else? Any administrative approval requests that you want to inform us about?
Yes, there's one SPR 1925, which was the application of Baker Properties Limited Partnership, who's the owner applicant, for reduction in outdoor storage area. This is in conjunction with the application that you heard and approved this evening for the SDD zone over at 1559 King Street. So it should have been part of just the application, but it ended up getting split out mostly to show that there is a reduction and they're not increasing the overall outdoor storage.
Okay.
So, then I do have one receipt of applications, public hearing 3083, which is regulation amendment for vet care in the BL zone.
Right. Will that be on next? Will that be on the 21st or would that be January?
I believe so.
21st.
On 21st.
We're gearing it towards that, but we're getting continuations to the next meeting, so I'll have to assess that.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Anything else? Mm-hmm. Seeing none, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion made by Vice Chairman Higley, seconded by Vice Chairman DeGray to adjourn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
And it's 9:10:33.
Good night, everybody. We're adjourning at 10:42.